Good evening. On Tuesday, June 17th, 2014, I want to welcome everybody as we call our regular school board meeting to order. Would Clerk Sligo-Punko please read the roll? Okay.
Thanks, Chair Murnicky. Member Harla?
Here.
Member Johnston?
Here.
Member Leffler-Kemp?
Here.
Chair Murnicky?
Here.
I am here. Member Welty?
Here.
Member Westholm?
Here.
Superintendent Gronseth?
Here.
Assistant Superintendent Crawford is excused. Deputy Clerk Hansen?
Here.
Secretary Thiebel? Oh, she's here. And our student representatives are also excused. We have a quorum, Chair Murnicky.
Thank you. Would the audience please join me as we honor America with a Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America,
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Thank you. Can I have a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
It's been moved by Member Sligo-Punko. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Member Harla. Any discussion? Member Johnston.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I'd like to make a motion to amend the agenda by adding discussion on how the agenda is set and possible bylaw changes.
Second. You made a motion to do what? I'm sorry, hold on.
Make a motion to amend the agenda by adding discussion on how the agenda is set and possible bylaw changes.
Bylaws changes, possible bylaw changes. Right now we're just moving to approve the agenda. If we're going to have a discussion of policy, I think we need to do that through our committee meetings. Member Johnston.
Oh, yeah. No, we have a motion. I believe we can speak to the motion.
Okay. All right. Member Johnston.
Yeah, I brought this up on the committees several times. I brought this up on email several times. I formally requested this agenda item on June 6th, and that was following the procedure in bylaw 9075. And as a response to this, there's a couple of responses which I think is important for the board to know in discussing whether or not we want to vote for this. And one, the superintendent responded to this email, I believe it was on June 3rd. And he stated that the agenda is determined by the chair and the superintendent. And Chair Murnicky and myself had discussion on this agenda item, and he said he's not responsible for determining the chair, for determining the agenda. There was then some correspondence back and forth from the superintendent, and he said that that the agenda determined by him, basing on a something, is why I don't get put on the agenda. Reminding the board that I've never had an agenda item put on and for the last 4 years. He said the item was already discussed and voted on. This item had not been. The item is part of an ongoing investigation, mediation, or arbitration. That was not the case. Or it's planned for a future meeting. So those three criteria, none of those criteria were met and why this agenda item was not added. And so again, I'm asking the board here to do the right thing and start having the agenda be followed and that the actual board be participating in the agenda. And I'm gonna give this, I did write proposed amendment to policy 9075, which I'll read this to you as well. It says that the 9075 will be stayed the same, except the agenda setting session will be held on Tuesday, 2 weeks prior to the regular meeting. All board members are welcome to attend and participate in this session. And item is agenda. Any proposed items submitted by two or more members will be included on the agenda of the next scheduled school board meeting. I'll pass this on. So if this gets accepted in this agenda, I will be submitting this. And of course, I've already submitted this via email. And as you indicated, Mr. Chair, that this should be brought up in a committee meeting. It wasn't. So again, I'm asking the board here to do the right thing and start being participatory in setting our own agenda, not having the superintendent determine our agenda. So I'm asking people to vote for this motion to amend the agenda to include this discussion tonight.
Member Welty.
Yes, in my experience when I was on the school board prior to this, it was fairly routine. If two members requested that something be placed on the agenda, that was generally managed if it was done in advance of a meeting. That never raised any particular controversy. There is no guarantee that just because something reaches the agenda and is discussed, there will be any particular outcome. Two members do not a quorum make. But one of the principles of parliamentary procedure is to make sure that the minority has an opportunity to speak its mind. So it strikes me that because we have done this in the past with no particular controversy, we go ahead and have a discussion. I'm not sure that I would necessarily go along with the entire verbiage that Member Johnston has suggested. I don't know that necessarily everybody has to be in the agenda setting session, although I believe that the City Council has a meeting that is an agenda setting session so that all the city councilors do that. I certainly do think the idea of more than one person representing the board at an agenda setting session makes sense. When I, on my brief stint as a chairman, took over, I invited those people who were in opposition to the larger group, give them a chance to sit under the agenda setting sessions so that they could see that there was nothing untoward that was going on. So this just seems to me a reasonable item for us to discuss at some point in the future. And I am particularly concerned about this because about a month ago at a committee meeting, Member Johnston raised an issue that I find troubling, the question about whether or not a $19 million change order that was not voted on by the board should have been. And we were summarily told at that meeting that there would be no discussion of this. It would not be placed on the agenda. And I think a potential violation of the law took place. And to be told now that because I am sort of in a permanent minority of two for the next year and a half, I'll have no opportunity to discuss anything in the larger, wider community that I think is of importance, I find very troubling.
Member Slagle-Punkel.
Thank you, Chair Murnicki. I just want to mention that this whole amendment to the approval of the agenda, this motion, has been asked and answered multiple times, numerous times, I don't even know how many. And I know I pulled up from the year I was chair in 2011 a whole list of agenda items that Member Johnston had submitted. And I know that we had a complete meeting on that and went through every one of those. So, and I know I gave you a copy of it. I apologize I didn't bring it tonight. But I did make a copy of it for you because I found it. So just want to remind you, Chair Murnicki, that this has been asked and answered numerous times, too numerous to even count. And I think we need to just move on. The one thing with regard to the City Council, and we have talked about this, we are not the City Council, and our committee meetings are actually like the agenda setting session. We sit and discuss all of our agenda items, and the agenda items that are brought forward from each department are to run the school district. You know, that's why we have an education committee meeting and an HR committee meeting and a business committee meeting. All of those issues are discussed at length, and each of those departments bring the agendas to run the school district. Nothing else. And so That's what we need, is to run the school district. And I just want to submit that this has been asked and answered again. Thank you, Chair Wernicke.
Member Johnston.
It's very important to state that, yes, I have brought this up. I brought this up a month ago. But it's very clear to point out to the public here that these committee meetings, we brought this up at the committee meetings. We don't talk about an agenda. The agenda is predetermined, as Mr. Sligo-Punko said, by the chair people of certain divisions that submit those. So, and more important is that she was talking about a year ago, I said I haven't had an agenda item in 4 years. The first year was a very nasty year. We did talk about an agenda item at one time, yes. It hasn't happened in 4 years. I can certainly give the list. I think the superintendent is well aware of my numerous requests, which are very normal. Now, Member Sligo-Punko said, well, this has been talked about many times. We've made this decision. I have asked this to be part of an agenda. It has never been put on as an agenda item. I have requested it. It has been turned on by this board numerous times. And I'm asking for this. I will keep asking it. Now, as Member Welty stated, just because a member, an item is on an agenda, doesn't mean that the board has to vote for it. I would suspect that if I brought my proposal, that would be talked about and the board members could decide to do what they want. And being that this is probably going to be a 5-2 board for the next year and a half, I suspect none of my proposals will get made. But as Member Welty also stated, it's a principle of parliamentary procedure and law that the minority has given a right to speak. The minority is given a right to have discussions. And again, I brought this up that this is violating this. This is violating our rules. More important is violating ethical procedure that is barring the minority to do this. And no, this has not been ever on the agenda because this board has always said we won't even discuss it. And of course, we're now having a discussion now, trying to get it on the agenda. We can't do anything until it's put on the agenda. So I'm asking it to be put on the agenda so we can have a discussion finally and have let the minority speak. And I would think that not only is it myself, a minority, but I think maybe sometimes other board members will find that they would also like to add something to the agenda. And they will find out, the new board members will find out, that they will not get to add an agenda item either. And I think that that is a serious breach of parliamentary procedure and the way boards should work. So I'm asking the boards to side with me on this because it's an important issue that you yourself may also confront. And I certainly hope you do have some agenda items occasionally.
Superintendent Grandseth.
I just wanted to point out that agenda setting session includes the chair, the clerk, and myself. I do not set the agenda. When I receive items from members, I bring it to that session, and the email response that you received from me were from my notes from that meeting and not a personal message from me.
Member Welty.
Thank you, Chair Wernicke. I'd like to respond to one of the things that Member Sligo-Punko just said, that the committees of the school board frequently act as an agenda-setting session, but I've discovered that that does not seem to be true. I was roundly criticized by the chair of another committee when I brought an item that was not placed on the committee's agenda. So apparently there is not only an agenda setting session ethic where the school board meetings are concerned, there is an agenda setting session where the committees are concerned. So if I cannot bring an item to be discussed at a committee of the school board, and I cannot in concert with one other member bring an item before the larger school board to discuss at a school board meeting, I guess that makes me feel somewhat impotent and gagged.
Member Loeffler-Kemp.
Thank you, Chair Murnicki. I was going to ask Superintendent Gronsett just to make sure the public understands how the agenda session is set up, so thank you for doing that. I wanted to add that when we came on the board as new members, we did ask what the process for getting an agenda item on, and we were told what that process was. And I have found that the agenda items that I was aware that were asked have appeared on the agenda, including the one we're going to be voting on at the end of the night, the special resolutions on the civility code. The other thing that I just have to speak towards, Member Welty, as you talked about bringing in, information to, it was my committee, the business committee, and the concern with that was also that it was a packet of information that wasn't quite complete information, I mean, a page here, a page there, and so it wasn't just that you brought this packet of information and wanted to discuss, but it wasn't, it didn't appear to be complete information and kind of a mixture of information. So let's make sure the discussion that happened at that meeting is really represents what happened. Thank you.
Member Johnston.
Sure. Just to try to finish up here, we can go on as that. Well, I've asked many things to be on the agendas, on committees, and they haven't appeared. And I guess to just to echo what Member Loeffler Kemp just stated, it proves my point. She's apparently got agenda items on, and apparently me and Member Welty can't. So I guess I'll make a correction there that some members with favors apparently get items on, and other members in a minority do not. And again, I think that's unfair. And just to make a correction from the superintendent, this was an email sent from him to the school board, signed by himself, and he says that item submitted to the board chair and superintendent. That's what he stated. If he stated that wrong, that's not my fault. That's his.
Superintendent Grunseth?
That's correct. They get submitted to me or the chair, but the agenda is decided by the chair, the clerk, and myself.
Seeing no other, Member Johnston?
That wasn't stated in his email in the clarification. He just stated these three reasons why he would not put them on the agenda. He didn't say anything about anybody else. Just a clarification.
Seeing no other discussion, we'll vote on the motion. And I apologize to Member Johnston. Is this the blue is what you want me to read? For the motion, I don't have the motion verbatim.
Oh, I can read it.
Okay, Member Johnson will read the. Thank you, Member Johnson. If you'd read the motion.
Sure. Just a clarification first. What I gave you, Chair, was that was the thing that I was hoping to discuss if we had an agenda item. The only way we'll get to that is if we do vote affirmative, and it takes a unanimous vote to change the agenda. But I'm giving it to you as I was sent out by email, and I hope that you, Mr. Chair, if this does not get passed right now, that this is considered in the near future.
Thank you.
So I will read my motion again. My motion was to amend the agenda by adding discussion on how the agenda is set and possible bylaw changes.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. All in favor of amending the agenda, signify by saying aye. Opposed, say no. No, it fails. Okay, we move on to approving the agenda. Member Johnston.
Yes, I have another motion, again, to amend the agenda. This motion reads, discussion on $11.2 million on change orders between ISD 709 and Johnson Controls occurring between 2009 and 2013, but that were never approved by the school board.
Is there a second?
There's a second.
Second by Member Welty. Member Welty, you go first.
As I indicated previously, I am concerned when there are change orders that are signed by one board member and not voted on by the board as a whole. Ironically, in February or March, the state auditor, Rebecca Otto's office, sent us an email that she sends out apparently to all elected officials across the state of Minnesota to make sure that we mind our P's and Q's. And in this email, she sent out a warning to all elected officials to make sure that no individual member of a board or a city council sign a check for an expense that was not voted on by the entire board. The danger to them being that without that, they might be personally liable for the expense, because these are all supposed to be approved by the board. So Member Johnson has just mentioned that he would like to have a discussion of $11.2 million having to do with change orders for Johnson Controls, Inc. And I have not yet heard back from the state auditor on a letter that I sent her concerning this issue. I'm hoping that before the election I hear from her on it. She's already indicated that this is a no-no, and I would like to have a discussion of this at some time. And tonight would be a good place to start.
Member Johnston?
Sure. I have requested this and gave previous notice of this agenda item on April 22nd and April 24th, 2014. I also gave had to get up because I wasn't included then. I had to get up and we give a public statement about my concerns. Since then, I submitted a data request on that. And I got a note back from Mr. Hansen that said the answer to this would cost me personally $2,100. I didn't think that, as a school board asking about what happened to $11 million, that I would be denied that until I pay $2,100. Of course, I will be pursuing this, of course, with the Department of Administration. Rather than going and having the Department of Administration go through this, what's going to be a lengthy and expensive hearing on this? I thought we as a board could ask the administration to produce this data. It's certainly not going to take thousands of pages. I'd like to know where this money went and what it was spent on. It should be a fairly simple request. I'd also like to point out that this request is particularly important now because Governor Dayton signed less than a month ago the law known as the Timberjay Bill. This law was also passed unanimously by the Minnesota legislature. And this bill was a result of a lawsuit brought by the Minnesota Newspaper Association against Johnson Controls Incorporated, having to do with the St. Louis County schools. Johnson Controls refused to give information on their subcontracts on that. And due to a loophole, this law closed that loophole, so it says that all subcontracts by anybody, including Johnson, even Johnson Controls, will now be public knowledge, and you cannot deny that information to people that are asking. Not only am I not the public, I happen to be a school board member, so it seems like I shouldn't have even had to mention this, but since administration obviously doesn't respond to any of my responses or ask me to shell out $2,100, and actually $2,105 would be correct. So it's particularly important that we as a board address this, because this is going to end up costing us more money again due to stonewalling by this district on something which the law now states that we deserve and we are entitled to have. And I hate to have to take legal action to get the district to abide by the law. So I think that we as a board should intercede and say it's time that we get it. That's a simple request, and I'm asking for the board here to do this now to avoid cost in the future.
Member Westholm.
Well, point of order, and I hate to be nitpicky, but a lot of issues in this request, but doesn't this belong with a business committee?
Yes.
And should we should it be delayed until then, or what's the proper procedure?
Well, I'll answer that. What Member Johnson's asking is that we add this to the agenda and have the discussion today. Is that right? Member Welty.
Yes, it was at a business committee meeting that we were told point blank that this would not be included on a future agenda.
Thank you. Member Loeffler Kemp.
Yeah, just again a clarification for the business committee and again for the public. Just so you know, we have regular scheduled education committee meetings, business and human resource committee meetings, and the public is always welcome to be a part of that. But in terms of the business committee meetings, I do want people to know that Mr. Leiter, one of our administrative staff, at every business committee meeting does updates on changeovers. And in fact, I believe it was the April meeting where he spent a great deal of time giving the history, which was very helpful for Member Harla and I on the history of change orders as well. So again, in terms of change orders, we do get updates on that. We get it in writing. We have an opportunity. And again, Mr. Leiter spent a great deal of time, at least at one meeting, just explaining the history. Thank you.
Thank you. Member Johnston.
Sure, I'd like to again thank Member Loeffler Kemp for saying exactly what I wanted to say. Yes, Mr. Leiter talked about the importance of change orders, and that change orders will be approved and they're sent to the board. And of course, this is exactly why I brought this up. This was $11 million in change orders that were never brought toward the board. Member Welty and I went through every board book back to 2006. Not everyone, but almost everyone. It wasn't there. I talked to previous board members. They weren't aware that nothing had happened. So, yes, absolutely. Member Loeffler Kemp is correct. Mr. Leiter was correct that members, these are supposed to come to the board. And the reason I'm bringing this up is that those rules, in fact, our policy that even states set, was not followed. And this is a serious matter since it's $11 million. This is not a something small, like say $50,000. Most people think that would be significant too, but this is $11 million that we're talking about. I think it's important to go on, and I'd like to also say again that Chair Murnicki, at that meeting, he assured us that this would not be swept under the rug. And then that has changed his mind later when he said he has nothing to do with the agenda and it won't appear. And again, that's why we bring it to the board, because that information has to be brought out, and it's not a laughing matter.
Member Walty.
I hate to disagree with my fellow board members, Member Leffler Kemp and Member Johnston, but while it is true that that Kerry Leiter has been very, very helpful in explaining the process, the billing, and all those technical details related to the long-range facility planning and Johns controls, I recall a very long and detailed explanation from him on the subject of reimbursables, which is not quite the same as change orders. Not that Mr. Leiter would be opposed to explaining the change orders that we did not vote on.
Okay, seeing no other comments, Member Johnson, would you help me out and please read your motion again? Thank you.
So, motion to amend the agenda by adding discussion on $11.2 million on change orders between ISD 709 and Johnson Controls Incorporated, occurring between 2009 and 2013, but that were never approved by the school board.
Thank you. All in favor of the, it's been moved and seconded. All in favor of adding this to the agenda, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no. No. It fails. Okay. We go on to approval of the agenda. Member Welty.
I would like to put in a request at this date that at our next business committee meeting, we have a discussion of this subject. And I just would like it to be known that I would like to discuss it at that time. Perhaps this is
a little hurried and rushed, but that is my request.
Thank you, Member Welty. We're voting on approval of the agenda. All in favor of approving the agenda, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
It was a 5-2 on the agenda. Thank you. We move on to number 5, reading and approving the minutes. Regular school board meeting, May 20th, 2014. Do I have a motion to approve? Moved by Member Harla. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Member Westone. Discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? No. That passes unanimously. Special school board meeting, May 27, 2014. Sale of property. Is there a motion to approve? Moved by Member Westholm. Is there a second? Second by Member Harla. Discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Nay. That passes unanimously. Special school board meeting June 10th, 2014. Is there a motion to approve?
So
moved by Member Westholm. Is there a second?
Second. Oh,
second by Member Seligapunkle. Any discussion? Member Johnston.
Yes, I noticed that this is a charge where the school board is starting an investigation against me. Make sure I have the right minutes. Is that correct, Mr. Chair? Did we lose track of minutes? That's correct?
Yes.
Okay. Again, the votes, one of the charges was that I assaulted the superintendent and the chairperson of the board. I think it's inappropriate that the chairperson of the board was able to vote on this. He should have been recluse from this, and since he's one of the people charging, I'm asked that this meeting, I'm not going to ask that it be invalid, but it certainly was a legal procedure because the chair should have reclused himself because he was one of the person charging me with assault.
I recused myself from running the meeting.
But you voted on every motion.
Okay.
And I think that was inappropriate, and I'm not quite sure what the result of the board wouldn't change anything, but I think I'd like to have it noted that in this case, the chairperson should not have voted on something where he himself is accusing me of assault. I think it was inappropriate.
Thank you. Member Welty.
I agree that Member Johnson's probably right that the chair should have recused himself from voting on this, but this is an unusual case, and I will note that the chair did the right thing in recusing himself from chairing the meeting, and I would prefer to think of that as simply an oversight. Since the results of this meeting, however, might render me part of a 6-1 minority on the school board, I take particular concern in it. I am quite happy to vote that these were the minutes of the meeting. I think that they will come to be regarded in this community as infamous minutes and no thing for anybody who was a part of it and voted for this investigation to have done, but it certainly took place, and I have no particular objections to the minutes in terms of the factual reporting of what took place.
Thank you. Seeing no other lights, all in favor of approving the minutes, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Do we get 7-0? Okay. Thank you. Now we move on to something I think the entire board enjoys, is school and community recognition. I'm going to ask Mr. Swirsky to approach the mic, and then if the board would go forward.
Members of the board, this month I'm pleased to present Pheasants Forever of St. Louis and Carleton County for recognition. A warm welcome to Phil Storstein, Chapter President, Matthew Brimmer, Chapter Vice President, and David Lude, Chapter Youth Director, who are joining us this evening. A little over a year ago, Pheasants Forever presented a check for $18,670 to ISD 709 to be applied towards the purchase of land for Habitat for Homecroft project. This project helps provide hands-on learning about wildlife ecology, conservation, and biology within a natural environment. More recently, they provided support for the outdoor classroom through a donation of about $2,000 in curriculum and equipment. This donation will allow all grades to explore, photograph, and study nature with a hands-on approach in the Habitat for Homecraft outdoor classroom. Many thanks to Pheasants Forever of St. Louis and Carleton County for their support in inspiring and educating our students. And now I understand, after this presentation, the representatives from Pheasants Forever have a presentation they would like to make.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. It is our pleasure tonight. We had the opportunity to work with Lester Park Elementary School. As the board probably knows, and many of you know, Lester Park does have a school forest that is mainly accessible. However, Lester Park had one part of their school forest that was not accessible by those with a physical limitation. They wanted to do a bridge, a brand new bridge, so that the whole school forest would then be accessible. We did work with Lester Park, challenged them to come up with half of the $5,000, which they received that, and we're happy to present Lester Park Elementary School with a check for $2,500 so they can complete their bridge in their school forest and have the whole school forest now accessible to those even with physical limitations.
I've often said we have such a wonderful community. We have so many organizations that help our school district in so many ways. I appreciate it. I'm going to pre-warn the people that I did some work outside today, and I can just feel my hamstrings tightening up. And if I get up and start jumping around, I'm not having a heart attack. But okay. We now move on to the audience portion of our meeting, and again, what we ask is that everybody treat each other with respect. No personal insults, if we can. Just we want to stick to the issues. We have 3 minutes to speak, and if you look at the timer over here, you'll see it start blinking when the 3 minutes are close. We want to welcome everybody to the podium. We'll start off with Anita Stetch. Welcome, Anita.
Chairman Runicky, members of the board, administration, and guests. My name is Anita Stetch, 2420 East 6th Street, and I'm here with my colleague, Rob Carwath. We want to thank you for your consideration of the special resolution to reaffirm the acceptance of the 9 tenets of civility. And the cards that are being passed around have those tenets on it, and they're also on that poster there. Through the Duluth Superior Area Community Foundation, a small group has been working on civility projects since you last affirmed this, and I think it was March of 2012. We use the definition of civility from the Institute for Civility and Government as claiming and caring for one's identity, needs, and beliefs without degrading someone else's in the process. I want to repeat that. Claiming and caring for one's identity, needs, and beliefs without degrading someone else's in the process. Our work has included, among other things, developing and promoting civility-certified forums for those who are running for office, and we thank those of you who participated in those forums in the fall. We'd like to extend the notion of civility certification from just candidate forums to meetings that focus on issues. And in that regard, we'd ask you to identify any meetings that you're having with ISD 709 or other such events that may benefit from promoting a civil approach to the difficult issues that face us so that we can help you structure some things to assure that people will use civility in their communications. And we also ask anybody else who's here that if you're aware of any community members or if you're setting up some forums or on issues, if you would contact us so that we can, again, structure it so that we can get, we can work with civil behavior. So, getting back to the issue at hand, we strongly urge the school board members to pass this special resolution. And if you do, we'd be happy to supply you with these little cards listing the 9 tenets so that you'd be able to distribute them to anybody who attends these meetings. And our hope is then that they would pass them on to people, kind of a civility wave concept. It just keeps moving on. We trust that these tenets will be used as tools as we discuss and resolve conflict. We're not really naive in our promotion of civility. We know that our community faces difficult issues. And we live in a state and a country that has recently shut down government operations due to the lack of cooperation and disregard for civility. But respecting each other as we agree and disagree in a civil manner is a worthy goal, and one that we hope each and every person who has an interest in our children's education shares with us. We've begun to work at the local level, and we can grow this to the state and national level as well. So thank you all for putting civility on the agenda. It's well worth the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Our next speaker is Paul King. Welcome, Mr. King.
I brought a sign. Here.
We'll just put it right.
Right there.
Mr.
Chairman?
Okay, civility. Point of order. So, excuse me for a second.
First of all, give me it.
Mr. King, for a second, I'm sorry. Mr. Welty? He has a point of order, and I'll give you.
I have a point of order, Mr. King.
Okay.
I appreciate your freedom of speech, and but what I'm going to ask that you do is confine yourself to the speech tonight. We can put signposts up here, and we've already seen it. We know what your point of view is. I would ask you to just take the sign back to where you had it originally rather than have it here on the dais. And then when you do that, please proceed to your speech. I'll be very eager to hear what you have to say.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. We'll reset the timer to start when you begin.
Okay, first of all, since you're talking about Robert's Rules of Order, there's no reason why the administration should be seated on the board. He is not elected. He does not belong sitting with you. That's definitely not within Robert's Rules of Order. So until you figure that one out and get him down where he should be seated instead of on the board, he's not elected. It's really hard to take advice from you people. I'm citing here the Civility Project. Number 7, apologize. First of all, you should all apologize to Mr. Johnston for your foolish position you took at that last meeting. I'm telling you, they owe him an apology, and they should withdraw that, oh man, my Ray-Bans. They should withdraw that whole investigation while they have the chance. It's one of the most foolish actions I've seen by any governmental body in the 30 years that I've been studying Duluth politics, 40 years. So you get a chance now, you can withdraw it. I mean, we're going to spend money to have a law firm investigate Mr. Johnston because what he was finger pointing at somebody, from what I hear. Where's the Duluth police? Why can't they? They would investigate it for free. Well, see, you're throwing our money around. Well, you're supposed to be helping us with class sizes. You know, they just raise taxes on us. What are they doing about class sizes? I bet you nothing. I bet you they're going to be bigger than ever. In fact, I'm getting wind that they already are. They just took the money that they paraded children in front of everybody to give right to the teachers' union. So, and what you raised the voter, the non-voter approved levy every single year. You guys are the worst, the absolute worst governmental body in this area. I think in this entire state of Minnesota. You're heading down the road of the Philadelphia School District. That's where you're heading. That's where you're moving this. And I realize I violated, show respect. Maybe that's, I apologize for violating this. This is very handy. Where'd they go? Very handy. I need this. But number 9, take responsibility. You're failing. You're doing a poor job. And you're going to silence the only opposition who's looking out for actual taxpayer money? Not everyone. He's the only one who's not a teacher or a retired teacher or all union members. I realize, but you get rid of them, then you have the Politburo. Is that what you want? You want to have just a
here.
Yeah. Give constructive criticism. Well, I'm doing that. Number 8. Be agreeable. I'm agreeing that you should drop this. Not gossip. Well,
Mr. King, we're over our 3.5 minutes now. If you'd like to wrap up, I'd appreciate it.
Okay. Well, I think I'm about through anyway. But thanks for your time. And save yourself. Drop it.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Israel Melikai. Mr. Melikai, welcome.
Hello, thank you. I'd like to introduce myself. I'm your boss. My taxes went up 17% this year, and it's largely due to the tax increase from the school board. So I feel that I would like to second the sentiments of Mr. King as far as paying a private law firm to investigate an assault. As a citizen and as your boss, I'd like to see the medical report on the injuries suffered at the assault and the police report, where I presume the police were called. This is going to cost, no attorney in Minnesota charges less than $200 an hour, so I'm sure this is going to cost at least several thousand dollars for this investigation, and I think it could be far better handled by our governmental officials. But another thing I'd like to add is I do believe that we need a complete shakeup in the Duluth School District. I'm furious that $11 million means nothing to you. You just, there was $11 million more. Well, that's a hell of a lot of money. And, you took a lot of money from me and my wife this year. And it hurts. I feel it. It's a few thousand dollars, but it's money. And I'm sure I speak for this packed crowd of citizens as well. Everybody felt this. And for you guys to stand up here smug and just, as though you're the captains of industry in the city of Duluth, and you can just urinate away our money like that, it's just reprehensible. And I'd like to call, as a taxpayer of the city of Duluth, for the immediate removal of Mr. Grunseth as school board chairman. Not school board chairman, superintendent of the schools. And I'd also request that this investigation against Mr. Johnston be summarily dropped before any more money is spuriously wasted on something that could have been handled by the Duluth police. And that's all I have to say. And I hope I don't have to come up here and speak to you again, because your meeting is extremely boring and I have better things to do. But I trust that in the future you'll take my wishes into consideration now that you've heard them.
Thank you, Mr. Malachi. Our next speaker is John Stromgren. Welcome, Mr. Stromgren.
I'm also a taxpayer that's the red plan taxes were raised by 17% on my business and 17% on my home. I don't know how you figure out that you're only going to raise my taxes on the red plan by only 11 or 12%. When I figure it out, it comes out to 17% also, as this gentleman here it is. I'm here to stand up for Mr. Johnston. He is one of the few people on this board that stands for taxpayers like us, the people who voted them in or him in to office. And he's standing for the taxpayers, minority groups, the students, the teachers. This board needs to drop its investigation on Mr. Johnston and save the money for our classrooms to reduce the size of our classes. And I also request that Mr. Johnston step down from this school district. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stromgren. Our next speaker is Rick Paulson. Welcome, Mr. Paulson. I'm sorry, I read Rick. Is it Richard Paulson? I apologize.
I've been here before.
I didn't put it together.
Yeah, well, you and I don't get along very well anyhow. Good evening. Without public comment at the last special meeting, I wanted to go on record supporting Member Johnston, and I asked that the governing five to consider other options if needed, which I question. I can only wonder why the district needs to hire two Minneapolis firms versus very capable law firms in the city of Duluth. I can only imagine what the costs are for travel for these two firms. I've also had an experience with Attorney Rupp relating to a data practice request of mine. Superintendent Gronseth hired Mr. Rupp rather than contacting me. Evidently, that was a better idea. When I asked the Superintendent Gronseth why he hired Mr. Rupp, his reply to me was, he did not understand my request, and he was and hired Mr. Rupp because he was not very expensive. In my opinion, Mr. Rupp did a very poor job, lacking research and actual facts of my request. The only reason the district won was because IPAD refused to allow appeal with the actual facts, and I'm still working on that. I continue to wait and wonder why not any board member can answer my email question that I posed on May 9th. Basically, I asked if any board member had seen the language relating to the health insurance and HRA accounts before approving a teacher's contract 5-2. Based on no response by anyone of the five, I can only assume no board member had access to the language prior to the approval of the contracts, except Superintendent Gronseth. How do the governing five justify their approval of teacher's contracts without knowing what's in them? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Paulson. Our next speaker is Jane Bushy. Welcome, Ms. Bushy.
My name is Jane Bushy, and I've worked for ISD 709 for 6 years as a nurse in a special education classroom. I'm here in support of Art Johnston in his role as my school board representative of the 4th District for the past 5 years. This investigation of him is the result of lies, accusations, and assumptions of the HR administration against me. Mr. Sworsky has not contacted me for any information on the allegations. I have not broken any HIPAA or IEP laws. He just assumed I was guilty. Mr. Dudley and Mr. Gronseth did listen. I felt they believed I was telling the truth. Even Mr. Murnicky stated at the start of the East High School graduation that it is all a misunderstanding and everything would be okay. Thank you, Byrne, for that. But by the end of the graduation program, everything had changed. From where I was sitting in the audience at the deck, I saw who was telling Mr. Gronseth lies about me. This individual has a history of harassing and bullying me at East High School, as well as lying in the community to protect herself and her family. And then Mr. Gronseth said I could not return to the students I had taken care of for the past 6 years. We were justifiably angry. I am not asking for a raise or a promotion. All I just want to do is my job and to be left alone. The only crime that R is guilty of is listening to me, trusting me, and defending my honor. Who would not want those qualities in a partner? And I wouldn't have them any other way. In my own life, if I tried to teach my own children the importance of telling the truth and standing up to bullies, I think these are important traits for all the children of this district. If we expect them to be good students and citizens, we must start by setting good examples. And that must start at the top of the administration. Thank you. And thank you for everybody for being here. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Ms. Bushy.
And happy birthday, Art.
Our next speaker is Danette Lynch. Welcome, Ms. Lynch.
I actually have two things. The first one is, Superintendent Gronseth, many times you've said recently that you desire more communication with the public. As a way of accomplishing this, would you consider what the City Council has started doing? They're having live stream meetings with the videos archived online so that you, rather than just, if you don't have cable, you can watch live on stream. And it's very helpful if you don't have cable or PAC TV. Possibly you could even share some of the technology or the learning curve that they had to get that implemented. It would provide for improved communication and community involvement. I was at the meeting last week and spent some time thinking about it afterwards. You three are having a personal dispute. I resent that I and all the other taxpayers are going to have to be writing a blank check because you three cannot work this out like reasonable adults. I would prefer, after two referendums and years of financial problems, that district money goes to what it should be used for, educating the children, not going overboard with this graduation incident. If it really was a big deal, it would have made the papers, the police would have been called, and everybody would have known about it before this meeting. Could you at least meet with an objective mediator or some other alternative, an employee assistance specialist or something that can help work through this so that it could be more quickly and less expensively resolved? It would also possibly improve relationships, unlike the investigation, which will only cause much further damage to the school board and everyone. Why should we have to pay for your personal disputes? And mainly, what kind of example, what kind of lesson is this teaching the staff and faculty, and more importantly, the students, regarding how to solve disputes and how to prioritize budgets? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Marcia Stromgren. Welcome, Mrs. Stromgren.
I want to thank many of the former speakers before me because you took my thunder. You said just about what I said, and I have not been talking to you, most of you, individually. Yes, 17%. 17% on our home and 17% on our business. For what? Your personal vendetta against Art Johnston, who's been representing me and this district for 2 years by himself. Thank you very much, Harry Welty, for coming alongside. Another five of you ought to be ashamed of yourself for using our children to get more money, and now you're going to throw it in the toilet to go after Art Johnston, who wants answers to how $11, $12 million. And I have watched you people for 6 years. I've been at the board meetings and the committee meetings, and I don't care what Loeffler Kemp says about codes of ethics and board policies. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know what? You don't even follow what's in your board policy book. Here's one of them. It says 9075 agenda for regular meetings. Time. Regular agenda items are to be submitted to the clerk prior to the agenda setting session preceding a regular meeting. Did any of you hear any exemption to this policy of who could submit these items? And yet Art Johnston has been kept out of this process ever since he got on the board, and Gary Glass, his predecessor, as well. I've got it on tape in my archival file. It goes on PAC TV, and you can't deny that fact. And it's okay if Sleeko Punko goes ballistic at Art Johnston at a meeting that I couldn't be there to tape. It's okay if she yells and screams at him. It's okay for people to point fingers at one another, and then we start charging people with assault. Yeah, I'd like to know why the police weren't called in. I'm fed up with your shenanigans. You talk about bullying. Yes, you are setting a very bad example for our children, for the rest of this community. And it's about time you got your act together, or else get off the board. You don't represent us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Stromgren. Our next speaker is Mr. Brad Clifford. Welcome, Mr. Clifford.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, Mr. Grunset. I consider five of you friends. We've gotten together, we've talked, and three of you I really don't know. I sit on a board also. And although in the city of Duluth, our city council and our school board were nonpartisan, the board that I sit on is the state DFL. As a representative to the Central Committee, and as a representative to the 8th Congressional District, and in the 7th Senate District. So, as a community organizer, I enjoy the debate, I enjoy the dissension, and I enjoy the dialogue. Hubert Humphrey said it best, as that is the cornerstone of democracy. I never quite understood when I met Paul Wellstone, what do you mean when you say we all do better when we all do better? And I find it difficult that we talk about inclusion, but we exclude the minority. I find it difficult when I sat on a nominations committee for this very board, and there were people from the Far East telling who should sit and represent people out in the 4th District. There were people that were running for office that were allegedly, from rumor and gossip, is what I've heard, which I take with a grain of salt, were handpicked and brought forward by various different people in the administration. And then there was other people who came forward. And silly me, going to all of the members of the 7th or the City of Duluth delegates at the convention saying, the process isn't done by us five people on this committee. The process is done by all you people, the voters. You members have the responsibility back to your precincts. The basis of our leadership sits in our neighborhoods. Doesn't sit by a handful of people. The power of my vote and my friends' votes really is the deciding conclusion of anything of who sits in the positions where you sit. And so when we ask for representation, we don't need somebody out in the far east to have an agenda. A chairman of a committee has to be a referee. And when it doesn't happen and things come through to affect and damage a character of someone, we've got a problem. So in a minority report, God bless those who stand up and speak out and try to bring collaboration. And God bless those good citizens who listen and do make the decisions. The 4th District voted. They need to be heard.
Thank you. That concludes our public audience. We now move to number 8, reading of communications and petitions. There are none. Oops. Apologize. I should read this. Letter addressed to the school board from, do I mention the name? Susan Romans, expressing her concerns related to the Duluth East co-curricular program. Thank you. Member Johnston?
Yes, I have a concern on this, is that we used to, up to about a year ago, maybe 2 years ago, receive these documents. We brought this up before. There's been no change in policy by the board. And I'm requesting again that when people send a letter, that that's actually given so the people in the public can know what we receive. And I would like to have that changed back the way it was, because there's been no change by the board to put that, to eliminate that being put on the, on there. And apparently some disagreement, and I'd certainly like to respond to that. Mr. Chair, you've been told to respond.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Johnson. We received this in mail.
That's my point. I restate again that up to about a year ago, whenever we received correspondences and communications from the public via mail, they're always put verbatim in the board book so people could see what was received. Not just a one-liner said we received something from a Susan Romans. I'd like to know what was received, and that's a policy of the board always in the past. And it concerns me that this somebody, not this board, has changed that, and I wanted to go back the way it was, which was when we received correspondences, we, the board and the public, are given notification of that by putting it into this.
Member Welty.
I agree with Member Johnston on this. We always had communications letters back in the old days before email in our board packets so that anybody come here could see what people wrote. Now, of course, the difficulty today is that most people send us email, and we receive quite a bit of email, and we have not followed the same practice with the email. I have mentioned, I don't know, recall if I did it at the school board meeting or in committee meeting or just in private conversations, that we think through just what we do with the email. Somehow it seems to me that it should be accessible to people who wonder what people are in the community are writing to us about. I do know that when somebody writes something that has to do with personnel or HIPAA or those sorts of things, they have to be excised or perhaps in their entirety not included in our comments. But it does seem to me that as thick as this packet is, we could put a few more packets, a few more pages in, especially if it was only the letters, because those letters are diminishing with time, and it's more and more senior citizens who send us letters. But I do think we need to review what we are doing with emails and other communications that we get. Probably we don't want to include text messaging or tweets, but I think when someone contacts the school board or the school district about a concern, they want a public reaction or at least some evidence that they have their comments have been noted in the record.
Thank you, Mr. Welty. I do want to comment. You were right on this. Is and I'll go to Mr. Gronseth next. Emails have certainly changed. And there's a reason why we don't publish those. If somebody writes a letter and discusses issues, policies, that will be
put verbatim. And I'm not discussing a particular one here. It's very important to notice that I am not discussing a particular one here, but it's what Mr. Welty said, is if a letter deals with a number of personnel in the district, then we get into some legal issues. And so we do have to watch out for that. Mr. Superintendent Gronseth.
I was just going to reiterate, as Mr. Welty said, Member Welty said, sorry, that this letter was pertaining to personnel issues, and for data privacy was not included in the public record.
Member Johnston.
Yes, this isn't the first letter that's been going on this way for over a year. We have not gotten letters on there. Of course, I expect any personal data to be redacted. That's a standard procedure in all bodies. We don't put personal data out there, but again, this isn't just this letter. This is a continuation of what the policy has been. And I suppose I could ask for an agenda item to get this changed. Okay, everybody laugh. But nonetheless, I will ask for this an agenda item again, and it will be responded to, but okay. But anyway, it's important. Again, we redact stuff, and it used to be they put everything in there, again, redacted properly to protect people. Now, email, we don't get as much hard copy letters anymore, but it seems like as a minimum, since we don't get very many hard copy letters, these letters should at least be included. Emails, as always, what do we do with emails? They're certainly available if anybody wants them through data practices and that kind of stuff. But as a minimum, the emails just show us more importance to put written letters, handwritten or written on the computer, doesn't matter, in there for public to see. So again, I'm asking that that policy be reinstated like it used. And I guess I will give previous notice that I want this an agenda item next time.
Thank you. We now move on to the superintendent's report.
Thank you. Well, another school year has officially closed, and we have graduated hundreds and hundreds of students that joined the thousands of Duluth alumni that came before them, so they become part of that proud tradition in Duluth. And it's a great opportunity to celebrate our young people and all that they have accomplished, because that's what it's all about. It is fun to see them excited about pursuing their dreams and hearing about the many plans that they have for their futures, going off to college or starting careers, trade schools. And again, this year, our graduates have earned hundreds of thousands in scholarships. And if you multiply that out to renewable scholarships, they have earned millions in scholarships this year, have a great deal to be proud of. Also, now that school is out, we have had many teachers, nearly 100, working on our curriculum alignment projects, and they're making good progress. I've been out visiting, and they are definitely working hard and coming up with some great answers. Teachers will continue to work through this through June, and then they will come back again in August to continue this project. Work has also begun on reviewing social studies curriculum as we are getting prepared to replace those materials. And you'll be hearing more about that as we get farther along in that process. Also, last week, our principals and some teachers and union reps all attended a professional learning community training down in Minneapolis. And it was a wonderful opportunity. I also have to say that the board chair joined us for that training, and it was a great opportunity for us to learn more. This week, the principals are learning more about MTSS, that's multi-tiered system of supports, and I was with them today and came back for the meeting, and we'll be rejoining them. This is all a part of increasing our student achievement, closing the achievement gap, raising graduation rates, and there's a lot of very important work being done this summer to those ends, and I look forward to the implementation in the fall.
Thank you, Superintendent Gronseth. We now move into the report of the SANE committees.
We'll begin with the education report. Member Harla.
Yes, thank you very much, Chair Murnicki. And I would echo Superintendent Gronseth. As a graduate of the district, it was really neat to be able to stand on stage and hand diplomas to students. And my mentee actually graduated this year. I don't know if I had a chance to tell the board members that, but a mentee that I was partnered with in Mentor Duluth graduated from Denfeld. Just lots of different stories of students that took them all the way from students. So many students cross the stage, and I just want to say that I really celebrate the students that graduated and also continue to think about the students that didn't have the opportunity to graduate, and want to commend the community partners that work with us and the teachers that help students get across the stage and all throughout the year work with our students. So happy summer from your education committee chair. Our first item one for the uninformational items was 5085R, student discipline for elementary and secondary schools. We went through Jim Erickson, Cheryl Leon, and Ron Lake presented the updated student handbook to our students. And this is something, just so members of the audience know, that in the past it wasn't a very accessible document, so they put it in an easy-to-read format. It's something that will be mailed out to every family to make sure that there's equity in communication. And then it's also available online with hyperlinks where there's something at the beginning and there's a question on a policy in the handbook. It can go straight down to that portion of the handbook. So a very big thank you to the staff that worked really hard on this. It was recommended that the item be received as informational, just on the updates for elementary and secondary schools. And I also want to note how both secondary and elementary work together on this handbook, and sometimes there's very different cultures between elementary, middle, and secondary. And I'm just glad to know that it was a consortium of people that worked on this. So thank you for that. The presentation from Laura MacArthur was tabled for an upcoming meeting due to the principal being at a principal's conference. He was on his way down there. The next piece was a presentation from Dave Taylor, who's our service learning coordinator for the Duluth Public Schools. And he presented an overview of a lot of service learning activities that happen in our district. Service learning is something that really can be done to enhance education. It's an opportunity to support curriculum and take kids outside of the classroom oftentimes, and getting involved in their community, and knowing that students oftentimes get opportunities not only to serve, but they learn about potential careers they can be in. It's something that as we encourage our students to find their spark, being a part of the world is very important. So I'm glad to know that we continue to support our service learning presentation. And I will note that we did receive some additional AmeriCorps members for the coming year to serve within that service learning program. And I know that Promise Fellows and now the newly reinstated True North AmeriCorps program are big service learning supports and just additional supports within our schools. So a thank you to Dave Taylor for that, who also will be retiring in October after a long service with our district. So a service learning presentation. This service learning position is connected to something we'll talk about in the HR committee. So just really glad to know that this is an option for our students and a priority at times. And thank you to teachers that work on this in their classrooms as well. Then we moved on to the action items, presented items requiring approval. We had the Duluth Public Schools AYES Automotive Curriculum Update and Adoption. I'm going to pull out my additional notes here. We had a great presentation from Phil Ranala, who's actually the award-winning teacher this year, and came in. But they talked about how they're updating this curriculum. We are actually one of eight programs in Minnesota that's recognized, and we're recognized nationwide in what we're doing with our programs. And so the reason they need the update for this is and actually this has been covered in grants for a really long time, and not something that has been a robust portion of our district of actually totally updating this curriculum. They focused on a certain number of parts of the car, and now there's a more comprehensive understanding of the whole workings of a car, similar to the district, so many different so many different systems. We have to understand teaching our students systems in this way. So it was recommended that we accept and approve that item for approval to update this, and the cost for the curriculum package would be $3,745.95. So, Chair, would you like me to...
We just go through all of these. We'll stop at the resolution for C.
The next piece were the general and honors biology curriculum adoption. What I'm really excited about this. This is it's a K-12 science curriculum review committee. Aaron Samala and Mamie Walters spoke to us about this. A group of teachers came together that teach science and worked really hard to find a curriculum that would work. I'm glad to know that there's not only physical books that will be up to date, and one thing they noted was that as soon as you print a, and I'm sure we know this, as soon as we print a book about science or biology, something new comes forward, and so I'm glad to know that we have technology components that partner with these. So, and teachers are really excited. There are online textbooks that are available, so students will not only have the opportunity, so say they're on a trip for class or they're someplace else, they'll be able to access the book online as well as have a hard copy for that. So it was recommended that the Duluth School Board accept and approve this item. The next piece that we had was the extended field trip request. Fourth grade students from Myers-Wilkins traveled to the Minnesota Zoo and the state capitol. So glad that our students had an opportunity to see a little bit of our state. So it was recommended that we accept and approve the above extended field trip request.
And Member Harlow, if you want to go over the resolution and move it.
Okay, great. For the field trip request.
28.
Yeah. Come on in. It's
28 of your packet.
It is. It's just a different page in my packet.
No, it's 28.
Oh, 28.
Resolution.
Okay. Thank you. I missed the number at the bottom there. So acceptance of grants and awards for the Duluth Public Schools. Oh, you were talking about the next piece. Sorry.
Excuse me,
Chair. I thought you were speaking with regard to the extended field trip request. So I'll move on to the resolution E-614-3188, acceptance of grant awards to Duluth Public Schools. So whereas Minnesota Statute 465.03 requires a school district to accept grants by a resolution expressed in the terms prescribed by the donor in full, and whereas acceptance by the grant in accordance with the donor's terms is in the best interest of the Duluth Public Schools, now therefore be it resolved that the Duluth Public Schools does accept the below described grants from said organization in accordance with the terms set forth herein. Be it further resolved that the Duluth Public Schools wishes to extend its grateful appreciation to these various organizations. And this is a grant from the Northland Foundation for the Kids Plus Youth and Philanthropy Grant for $995 awarded to Real World Science Project at Woodland Hill. So I move resolution number E-614-3188.
Is there a second?
Second
by Member Waffler Kemp. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor accepting this resolution, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Passed unanimously. We can continue on D.
Thank you. The next piece that we had was access to student data, and it was requested that the following organization be granted access to student information systems to support district functions, and there's a listing of organizations for that. An appreciation to Dr. Lake for joining us to give a little bit more of an overview at that meeting and talked about how we have, because of data privacy, some very specific guidelines when it comes to anyone being able to access student data. So there's a whole system in place. We not only received the agreement in our packets, we were able to read through, but Dr. Lake was available for questions, and so thank you for joining us. I'm glad to know that we continue to have stringent systems to keep our student data safe. So it's recommended that the Duluth School Board accept and approve the above annual data sharing agreements for the 2014-2015 school year. The next piece is a local education agency authorizer. So it's recommended that the Duluth School Board authorize Michael Carey, Director of the Curriculum, to act as the LEA representative for the Duluth Schools, and it's filing for application for funds provided under Public Law 10338. I don't need to read that entire thing, actually. So this is our new curriculum director, and I'm just glad to know that we have someone that's in place, and I understand he'll be starting right at the beginning of July. Someone that has had a significant history, has spent a lot of time supporting students. He actually was a UMD graduate and spent some time, he's currently the high school in, excuse me, where is he the current principal, or is he leaving right now?
Bismarck.
In Bismarck, North Dakota, the largest high school in North Dakota, and he also worked on a reservation on in a turnaround school when the first set of turnaround grants hit, so he has varied experience within administration. So understanding from a good pool of applicants, we are lucky to have him in our district. So look forward to, I'm sure he'll be with us at our next month's meeting. So it's recommended that the Duluth School Board accept and approve this item. The next piece was about the continuation of change in the contractual day for the educational audiologist. The reason that this is a change is that the audiologist oftentimes meets outside of school hours or regular business hours so that they're able to accommodate the various needs of families that may need an audiologist. And so just very thankful, to that staff member for, I know she's been in our district for a very long time, and that she continues to support the needs of our families and our students that need this specific service. So it's recommended that the contractual day for Linda Callaway's educational audiologist be changed to reflect the work week defined as up to 40 hours and to include up to 10-hour days as mutually agreed upon with the Director of Special Services for the 2014-2015 school year. The next piece that we, item G, is policy 5085, the student discipline policy. I did speak about this in our very first item, but so they talked about the updates, but then they also talked that this will be a policy change for our student handbook, and I'll refer back to my comments from earlier in the meeting. So it is recommended that the Duluth School Board accept and approve policy 5085, student discipline policy, for the first reading. So the first reading of this. And then we have two diploma requests, and I did hear that I will not have to read a couple of hundred names next month, as we did already accept many, but again, just very large congratulations to Sarah Kathleen Shadeen and Eddie Michael Edwards. And it is recommended that the Duluth School Board accept and approve the above diploma requests, and I move my report.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Member Welty. Any discussion? Member Johnston.
I'd like to pull 1A1, and that's also 2G. I believe they're the same.
1A1. I'm sorry, I just got the first one. Yeah, 1A1 and 2G. Or not 2. I'm sorry, is it 2C? 2G. Where am I not seeing G? Yeah. Oh, okay. Any others? Member Harley, you want to turn off your mic? And Member Johnston? There we go. All right, Member Johnston.
Yeah, I got a couple comments on this particular one. For those that don't know, this is Student Discipline Policy 5085. And I like much of this, but I do have some concerns that I'd like to bring up. There's penalties that are clearly laid out in this. I think it's a little bit clear, and I think it's important to have penalties for first, second, third offenses and whatnot. But one of the things that's missing is that there is no reporting form that can be used by students. I think it's very difficult I don't think it's user-friendly for the people this is intended for. I think this is intended for to try to reduce bullying. It's part of it, the part that we talked about. There's a lot of other stuff in there, too. I'm going to concentrate on the harassment and bullying part. And I think it's important that some form be in there, that students are given some form that could be readily referenced and found so they could actually do it. Another concern that I have is that there's no process identified in this particular one for a student to report bullying by staff. And we know that's in 4015, but I wanted this thing is only about students being bullied by other students and excludes staff. And I think that this is an important, or it's an oversight which I think really shouldn't be there. I think it's an important thing. If I think this happens, we want to have all particular instances, not just students. And another concern I have on that is that such reports, I'm not sure how they're going to be reported, but these are kind of adjudicated by the principal. I have a concern with that, or a potential concern with that, is that I think that if there is a bullying thing, I've heard about this from many dozens of parents who have issues like this, and I think it's important that the parents and the student have another due process. I think that should be the school board. I think that the principal should not be the final adjudicant in this, but I think the school board should fall, and that's our responsibility to look into issues, and usually in closed meetings, of course, and do that. And I really would, I think it's important that the school board take that responsibility. Compare it to 4015, this is a policy more on harassment and bullying, and I believe it's sexual harassment is called. That has a nice reporting form in it. It's right in the policies anybody can find. But none of the problems with the 4015 is that there's no penalties identified. And what happens if somebody harasses people? It doesn't say. And what are the second and third offenses? It's not said. So I'm kind of looking at this, trying to look at how could we revamp those. I think both of those things could be done. I do have a question. I'm going to ask a question. I don't know if you have an answer, but getting back to 4015, I'm asking about the harassment form, and what I'm concerned about here is where I'm getting is that we can have great policy, but if the policy is not enforced, or if it's not used, the policy really isn't accomplishing what we are expecting it to have, and of course I support this policy. And I got a couple of questions. You may not be able to answer them. I'm going to ask them. Is that, does anybody know how many harassment complaints forms have been filed last year? I'm just trying to find out here, is this actually being used? We know there's harassment going on. We know there's bullying going on. And I'm just wondering if, is anybody actually filing these forms? And I don't know if you can answer that. I'm not asking for specific numbers, but has it been 100? Has it been none? I mean, you know, just give me a ballpark, and you know, we can certainly talk about it in the committee, too. Or I could hold off some of these questions if you wanted, Mr.
Chair. Yeah, point of it. Let's do this if it's okay with you. Why don't you ask the three questions, and superintendent can write them down and then answer them all at once, or would that be okay?
Sure, that'd be
all
fine.
All right, go ahead.
Oh, yeah.
The other one
was, then how many of these complaint forms are filed against the administration. Some of them are probably filed against other children, which we usually hear about, but I'm wondering if any have been filed against the administration. And I also would like to know is how many of those forms have been filed against the people that actually worked on 5085. I'd like to know, have any of those, any complaint forms been filed against the people that worked on that? And then the other question would be, what was the result of such harassment forms? Were these adjudicated? I'm not asking for personal data, certainly redact any kind of data that could be personal, of course. But I'd just like to know, again, where I'm going here. I think this is a very important policy. It was a law passed by the state of Minnesota on harassment, and I just think it's important that not only do we write something like this, which I think we should, I welcome the administration for doing this, I just want to know, I think it's up to us to make sure that it's being implemented properly. And so that's where my questions are coming from. I guess I'll just summarize what I'm, or you want to answer those? Sure, go ahead, Superintendent. No, the other one's just a summary. There's no other questions for you, so want me to finish? I'll finish. Again, I would like 8085 to policy revised to include a report form in a due process that includes the school board, of course, as a final adjudicant. That's probably the wrong word, but I don't know what else other word to use. And, of course, I'd like to have 4015 be revised to include penalties, particularly for repeat offenders. And certainly I will be submitting some of these ideas to the committee since it's the first reading, and you know, I will be doing that. And hope, you know, again, it's obvious this one's on the agenda, so I will be submitting that. I haven't written this. I'm not sure how to fit that in properly, and I'd certainly take any suggestions or advice from the administration on where some of my concerns, if there's agreement with that, or you know, say, hey, not a bad idea, how to fit it in. I don't really know where to fit that in. So that's my comments on this stuff. And Mr. Superintendent, if you want to respond, or just we can talk about it in a committee, but those are the concerns I've got.
Okay. Member Welty, you'll be after superintendent response. Member Johnson.
Okay, first of all, on the policy 8085 with the reporting form, that is part of the plan as we're responding to the new legislation, the bullying. We will be getting a community group together, community, students, staff, and working through the new legislation in a reporting form, both a paper and electronic is in the plan for going there. This being summer, it's a little hard to gather people, and so we're planning on doing that early in the fall, creating that form and including it. The legislation and the requirements of the legislation were specific to student, and I think you know that the 4015 is the one that applies to the adults in the district. I wasn't sure if you were talking about student to staff or staff to staff, but we, yeah. there have been forms filed. I don't have the number. I'll have to figure that out. Do I know if there are any against specific administration. Administration, do you mean district administration or school and district administration? Let him answer.
Oh, I'm sorry. Member Johnson.
Yeah. Thanks for the clarification. Asking for the clarification, I guess I would put down from the superintendent's cabinet down to the principals, assistant principals, and any directors. I guess I would include that in the administration, and maybe the staff, the non-certified administrative, or people that are say technology higher up than the directors on that, but may not be teachers and
supervisory.
Yeah, those kind of things, right?
Okay. Member Welty.
First of all, a point of information I should have tossed out a little bit before, but I'm quite happy to continue this discussion at this time. Did you get a chance to have everybody pull the items that they wanted for us to discuss? Because we've launched into the first one that I know is withdrawn, and I'm quite happy to continue on this way. In fact, it seems to me that at this point we should finish this one up, but I don't think that we've asked everybody to pull the items that they're interested in. So I would just simply suggest that we continue on, and when we finish this conversation, we proceed with asking if there are any other items to be withdrawn, if there are no objections.
No, and what we'll do is, Mr. Member Johnson, we'll do 1A1, and then we'll do 2G, and then if you want to pull something, we'll go from there. Okay, you can continue.
As it happens, I do not wish to pull anything else. I am, however, glad that at least one item was pulled. I have often heard board members talk to the community or those who are listening and say that we often have extensive conversations about things in committee, and oftentimes we've discussed them out, even though the community might like to know something about it. I'm particularly pleased that Chair Hall does a pretty good job explaining these items so that the public knows what's going on. I do think that the reporting form suggestion makes sense. I would like to point out that we did have an extensive conversation, I think two so far. This is just for a first reading, so there is time before the second reading to make some amendments to this. So I do think a reporting form to make this completely user-friendly for people who might have something to report makes sense. I will say the assistant principals in two meetings did a marvelous job explaining this process. It's often convoluted and it intimidates people. I'm very pleased that they have put an awful lot of effort into this. I think I had one more thing to say about that, but I think I'll just leave it at that. I do think the reporting form is a useful suggestion.
Thank you. Member Harla.
I'm glad to know that I know that there's a plan in place to move forward with the landmark legislation that was passed with the Safe and Supportive Schools Act. I do think, and from what I understand, that if there's a complaint within a bargaining unit, that they usually go to the union to do that. So I think that the union a lot of times says that, and then it lands to the Quality Steering Committee, and maybe I would defer to Mr. Sworsky about that with regard to when it has to do specifically with a staff member, and how there's a process in place for staff complaints having, and it's usually within bargaining units. Is that, Chair, do you mind if I would just defer to that? And then I have one other follow-up question.
Okay, a question for Mr. Sworsky, then back to Member Harla.
Yeah, primarily in the bargaining units, it's if there was a disagreement on how the contract was applied. But they do have other services that sometimes are provided for their staff or staff and others who may be invited. We've had, I know within our clerical groups, we've run bullying sessions between administration and clerical staff, just for our own educational purposes and for the purpose of establishing some of our own programs. But sometimes those are provided as part of their services that they have for their unit members and administrators if they'd like to attend.
Member Harla?
Thank you. And I am glad to know that this will be, that a form or some sort of reporting tool, I think what Mr. Johnson is saying about having that communication tool available is good. And I'm glad to know that it'll be a part of the process as we, because they're still walking, the Minnesota Department of Education is still coming out with the rulings for the Safe and Supportive Schools Act. Is that correct, Superintendent? So as we understand that, I wouldn't want our staff to go through a whole process and then have to change it because of legislation, because of a change or a ruling from the Minnesota Department of Education. But I want to keep track on how this continues in partnership with that. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Member Loeffler-Kemp.
Sure. I just wanted to, I guess, clarify a couple things with the 5085. The information that was given to us on page 16, the last page, does talk about student conferences, and it says, depending on the violation and the seriousness of the action, a student may meet with the principal and or a teacher to discuss the incident. Students may be asked to formulate a plan during this conference which addresses their behavior and a commitment to solutions for improvement. And I think when Ron Lake presented to us at one of the times, he had mentioned that it could be a principal or a designated person within the building. I seem to recall that. The other thing just on this, I just wanted to note that just, and this really is for the public, that in the past, the handbook has always been sent out to parents. This isn't the first time. So that's been a past process, and we want to continue that a hard copy gets out there to everybody. And I know that, again, the Safe Schools Bill, as noted, that there's still kind of process discussions happening with the MDE. And so there's, you know, I think all school districts right now are kind of figuring out how to implement this, not just where we're at. Thank you.
Thank you. I know a member who's had a lot of experience in this area, Mr. Westholm.
Yeah, more than I'd like in some ways, but a few things come to mind. A good discussion about this. In terms of, I think, if I understand what Mr. Johnson was asking, in terms of school board involvement in these kinds of things, the one and the most severe penalty that a student can get is expulsion, and the school board does have the final say on expulsions. You know, we do not get involved in, I spent 17 years in high schools dealing with middle school and senior high kids, And I also was fortunate enough to be one of the original drafters of this document. And when we were first ordered by the state to have a discipline document, and a lot of people worked real hard on it. And one of the things about these kinds of documents, it really is a living, evolving document. And that's why we have changes every year. For example, who would have thought about cyberbullying 10 years ago, 5 years ago? Well, now it's a very real thing. And so it spills over into schools. When that happens, we have to deal with it. And most of these things, whether it's in-school suspensions or simply calling a student in and disciplining in some way that way, or taking him out of a class for a couple hours, or a suspension, certainly parents are always involved in those things. Most of the times, it's certainly at the least a telephone conference, and very often a face-to-face conference. So I think our district has done a pretty good job at this, but again, it is a continually evolving document. And that's what I think has been good about this. You know, every year, of course, and I know every year we get together, and I don't do it anymore because I'm not a principal or assistant principal or a person working down here, but every year you get together and principals and others bring in, you know, what do we need to change? This one really isn't working. I'm sure this is going to happen with cyberbullying. You know, is this helping us address these problems with students or not? You know, if not, what do we have to change? And then you're talking to people in the schools and principals and people downtown, too, and saying, you know, what would work? What would help this work better for students and schools and staff? So, you know, I guess I'm doing a little plug for the district and the people who worked on this, but it really is a pretty good document. Is it perfect? Nah, nothing is. And there's always something changing, but I think we've done a pretty good job as a district addressing the needs when they've come up. And so it's fun for me, you know, if I don't know fun is the right word, but it's fun for me to look at this and to look at the changes and to see how it's evolving. And, you know, I think the district employees who worked on this have done a pretty good job with it.
Thank you, Mr. Westholm. Member Johnston.
Sure, it certainly wasn't my intent to be critical of the document. That wasn't it, and I certainly appreciate the discussion. I've been hearing about the bullying law for many years, and my son worked on some of those issues when the first bullying law in the country was passed in Michigan, and this is certainly an important thing that we have to do. I want to thank Member Harloff for asking, you know, the question, Mr. Sworsky. You know, I think going to the Quality Steering Committee does have to be revamped. I think this is something that, okay, I thought that's what he said. I didn't, want to jump in. Did I misunderstand what Mr. Sworsky said?
No, the QSC, the Quality Steering Committee, really does not discuss personnel issues.
No, okay.
There is cooperation with the union and the district administration in dealing with those, but the QSC does not discuss those.
Okay. Where does that discussion go on then? Could you correct that?
If it is a union issue, then it follows the grievance process. So there are different levels of grievance depending on the issue. And the staff involved goes through
the if it's not a grievance, not grievable, which many things aren't.
Well, it depends on the situation.
Yeah, sure.
So.
Okay. Yeah. No. Again, I'm just trying to find out. And kind of my point is, right. Is that I think we have to have a thing. You know, a little bit concerns me with the board. I think we're kind of not doing what I think is our responsibility. I think we should be, and of course, in closed session, when there's a dispute going on, particularly between that involves staff. I think that the school board should be involved in that. And it seems like the what's going on here is that the school board, if, for example, we can't talk about. You know, we're not. People have said on the board here that gee, we shouldn't be talking about it. I think we should be. I think we should be that last due process, put it that way, and I think it's important. I do want to say that I think that language in, say, for example, 4015 is excellent. but it's very, very weak on enforcement. And again, that I'd like to look at this and find some way to get that. I'm looking for your answers back on that. But this wanted to finish up by saying that I think the school board should be involved in more than just expulsions, but we should be involved, of course, in closed sessions with the privacy of data foremost, of course. And again, we can talk about that at the committee here. I'll probably have some suggestions with hopefully working with the administration on that. But I think it's important to have a little tighter due process in place. Thank you.
Member Harla.
I forgot to mention in my report that the staff that put the time into writing this actually did a lot of this. Because it's cross schools, they did this before school, really early mornings, a lot of late evenings. So on top of their regular job duties, they had this district-wide document that they worked on. So I just want to make sure to note that. Our appreciation.
Thank you. Okay.
Sorry.
No, that's all right. Don't be sorry.
Being the Safe Schools Bill has been acknowledged by a number of us, and many of us were very supportive of that legislation. I just wanted to say that we also had many students from our district, from the high schools, participate in advocating for the Safe Schools Bill, and while that does pertain to student and student bullying, I just was very proud of a number of students who were involved, as well as last month when students from both of the high schools had a community meeting on safe schools and worked to seek input as well, and I know a couple of us attended that as well. So, just a
thank you. Member Johnson, 2G, please.
I think that's kind of, I thought they're kind of both the same, I think. I don't want to say what I just said over again, but I forget what I said, so I hope everybody can remember for the committee.
I remember.
Okay.
All right. Are there any other items in the education report that anyone wants pulled? Okay. It's been moved and seconded to approve the education committee report. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passes 7-0. HR, Mr. Welty.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Human Resources Committee, regular school board meeting. We had our traditional staffing report action items. They included certified appointments, total 19, 4 certified co-curricular, 3 certified leaves, 2 certified long-term subs, 1 certified permitted increase, 2 certified resignations, 2 non-certified appointments, 1 non-certified demotion, 19 non-certified extensions, 6 non-certified leaves, 4 non-certified permanent decrease. There are 20 non-certified permanent increase. There were 3 non-certified promotions, 2 non-certified resignations, 2 non-certified retirements, 1 non-certified temporary decrease, and 1 non-certified temporary increase. We have a couple of resolutions that I will read.
Mr. Walty, excuse me, should we do what we did with the education, maybe read them one at a time and then we'll vote on them? Is that okay?
I'll just very quickly go through the resolutions, then I'll read them for you. There is a resolution on the termination of certified long-term substitutes and a placeholder, then a resolution on the termination of certified probationary non-tenured staff. We had another one, a placeholder, which is going to be withdrawn. That was a resolution on the termination of certified tenured staff. There is a placeholder, which I believe we will not be acting on now. There's no resolution, but it has to do with the approval of an assistant superintendent individual contract. That was for Eddie Crawford, who will be working with us at least 1 year, although some of us were impelled to ask if he would consider staying on even beyond the 1 year that he's requested. There was a discussion of the approval of a new position of civic engagement coordinator district-wide. We had a significant discussion about that. This would be a person who would, I believe, be working with students, getting them involved in the community, among other things. And then we have approval of a several-page teacher development evaluation document. for which there was an extensive discussion of a strange word that was on it, the very last page called ediate. And we had, and I was a part of this, trying to figure out what the word ediate was, only tonight to have Mr. Swirsky tell me that somehow the word immediate did not find itself printed onto the whole document. Then there was a discussion of policy 9045, negotiating committee review. We have a subcommittee of school board members who will be perhaps at their leisure, because we have 3 years to wait before the next negotiation, at least with the main teachers union, talking about just who sits for the school board on the negotiating committees. Those are the things that we discussed, and I do have two resolutions I would be happy to read when the time comes, Mr. Chairman.
I think the time has come.
Then we will begin with the resolution regarding the termination of certified long-term substitutes. It is our policy not to read the names of individuals, so I will leave that out. Whereas the school board desires to provide notice that long-term substitute teaching positions terminate on the date specified in the individual substitute teacher's contract or at the conclusion of the school year, whichever is earlier. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the School Board of Independent School District Number 709, St. Louis County, Minnesota, that the employment of all long-term substitute teachers, including those listed below, shall terminate effective at the end of the school day on June 6, 2014, unless another date is indicated below, or on the date specified in the individual substitute teacher's contract, whichever is earlier. There is one person listed here. Therefore, be it further resolved that the clerk of the school board shall so notify such teachers in writing before July 1st, 2014. Mr. Chairman, I move resolution HR-6-14-3187 dated on the date of June 17th, 2014.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Member Harla. Any discussion? Member Johnston?
Yeah, I got a question on this. As there's one person that's being terminated by a long-term substitute, and you know, we have a lot of substitutes, and I'm just kind of curious why we're terminating one. It seems like substitutes are kind of important. Was there a personality issue here? I'm not asking for any names or anything here, but was this particular for this one person? And I'm just curious, why was this one person almost looked like maybe singled out?
Okay.
I didn't think that was a laughing matter. I'm not quite sure.
We're having trouble with the mics. I'm having trouble with the mic again. Okay. Let's try this. I'm doing all I can to. Why isn't that working? You turn that off for a second. Okay, no, just turn it off and don't touch it. And. Oh, God. Bart, it just keeps blinking. Okay, I apologize. It's been working well all night.
You've got too many on. You got to turn.
Oh,
that's what it is.
I'll turn.
Turn yours off.
Oh, as long as I still have the floor when I'm done.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Okay. Termination of long-term substitutes. These are not our casual substitutes. These are individuals who are hired in for a teacher for a period of more than 30 consecutive days, and they're in for a person who has rights to a position. So the people that they are long-term substituting for could be on like a medical leave, could be on some other short-term or longer than 30 days leave of absence, those types of things, but they have rights to return to that position. So when we do hire a long-term sub for those positions, they generally have a start date and an end date. That's why you don't see a number of them on here, because most of the long-term subs, if we knew they were going to be there for the end of the year, we had an end date of 6-6-2014. This individual in particular, we didn't know if the other teacher was going to return before the end of the year or not. So when his long-term sub-appointment went through the board, it was with a date to be determined. So all this is merely doing is determining that date. There's nothing adverse or suspect about this termination. It's just more of accounting for where your individuals are.
Well, thanks for that explanation. And am I right to assume then that this person, if another long-term substitute position comes up, he will still be eligible for that?
This individual actually is teaching summer school for us. However, this position ended and he is hired for summer school. So, yes, he's in good standing with the district.
Good. That's what I want to know. Hoping he wasn't somehow banned forever from being a long-term substitute. Thank you.
Okay, Member Welty, back to you.
Thank you for that question.
Sorry about the...
We have a second resolution, the termination of certified probationary non...
I'm sorry, point of order, we have to vote on the one you just made. That was my fault. All right, any other discussion on that first resolution? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. And now, Mr. Welty, and again, I apologize.
That's okay. I hate to get ahead of myself. Because I'm frequently lost, even when I'm not.
I did it too.
The resolution regards the termination of certified probationary or non-tenured staff, whereas during the first 3 years of consecutive employment, all teachers in the public schools and cities of the first class are deemed to be in a probational period of employment, during which period the school board may renew or not renew any teacher's annual contract as the school board shall see fit. The term teacher, in quotes, includes every person regularly employed as a principal or to give instruction in a classroom or to superintend or supervise classroom instruction or as a placement teacher. Is that replacement teacher? Placement teacher and visiting teacher. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the School Board of Independent School District number 709, St. Louis County, Minnesota, as follows. One, the employment contracts of the following probationary teachers shall not be renewed, and their employment shall terminate at the end of the school day on June 6, 2014, unless another date is indicated below, in which case the employment of the particular teacher shall terminate on that date. There is one person listed below. And two, be it further resolved, the clerk of the school board shall notify such teachers in writing before July 1st, 2014 of the termination of their employment. Mr. Chairman, I move resolution HR-6-14-3186, dated June 17th, 2014.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Member Loeffler. Kemp, any discussion? Member Johnston?
We can't use any names here or something, but I'm actually a little bit concerned about this position. This was a position that was discontinued. We hired another person, basically, in his or her place, and I don't know. I just really don't like how that was operated and that was done, and I'm going to be voting against this because I think that there was the questions which I don't think that the individual was really treated fairly. I don't know any details. I'm not asking for details. It just seems like we had a person, made a new position, put a new person in, and that person that was just actually brought here very recently was ended up with nothing, and it didn't seem the right way to do it.
I'm just remembering that we voted on the change in this position with the change in the structure of our entire administration. So. It isn't a personal thing. It's the fact that it's to make sure that our district is in line with the changes that had been moving forward. So, and very much thanksgiving to this person for serving our district, but this was a part of a board action that we took to make sure that this position is within standing of making sure that we are in line with curriculum standard. Yes.
Member Johnston?
I guess when I did this, I didn't know this was going to be the impact or the effect of such a thing. And again, I think that, we did this, and it wasn't intended to cause any harm or any angst. We know that, but maybe it did. And I think that we should be a little more personal involved here when we do a position like this, and there's somebody that's that is impacted. I think we should have been more cognizant of that. And so and just because we did this without knowing anything was going to happen, I don't think just, it is not to me a good enough reason for me to vote for this. I think it wasn't a good way to do it.
Thank you. All in favor of the resolution signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 6-1. Thank you. Member Welty.
Mr. Chairman, should I move the adoption of the HR committee report? Then I do so.
Thank you.
Oh, there's one more item?
I'm sorry. We have a comment. Mr. Swirsky.
Just to reiterate some of what Mr. Welty said, the third resolution was basically been pulled because we did not have any individuals to name in that. Letter D, the placeholder approval of the assistant superintendent individual contract, is up for approval at this meeting.
Thank you.
Is there a resolution to that effect?
It does not require a resolution.
Okay. So we can open that up for discussion prior to voting. Okay. Is there? Do we have a second for the approval of the HR? Was it Member Leffler Kemp? Mr. Westholm?
Second, we need to move this.
Okay. I have a question for Mr. Swirsky. Do we have to vote on the assistant superintendent's individual contract separately, or can we just vote on it as part of the entire packet?
You are comfortable voting on it as part of the entire packet, you can move the remainder of the items.
And that's what I wanted to do. Thank you. Member Westholm?
Yeah, and I don't have a specific question, but before the meeting we were discussing, it's always pleasant when we're laying off as few people. I can't remember a time in all the years, and I've been involved a lot of years with this, that we've laid off so few people. And, you know, some of that is because of retirements and, you know, all kinds of reasons play into it. But it's really nice not to have this list so short. It's, again, we don't like to do it to anybody, but it's still very, it's a breath of fresh air to have it this small. So thanks for all your work.
Thank you. Member Welty?
Mr. Chairman, since the Crawford contract is a part of this and we don't have to have a special resolution, I move that we adopt the HR committee report as it has been presented.
Thank you. and it's been seconded. Member Lafferkamp, would you second it again?
Yes, I will second it.
And Member Lafferkamp has seconded it. Member Johnston.
Yeah, I'd like to kind of pull items on this. We typically don't on HR, but I did want to have some discussion before we vote on it.
Okay.
Item number one. And got a couple aspects of that. When I come to one question, it may not be the appropriate spot, but I'll take your advice when I get to that one.
Okay. Where we're at right now is it's been moved and seconded to improve the HR committee's regular school board meeting. We will hold off on that and attend to the pulled items, and so we'll go to Member Johnston.
Yeah, when I read this, there's a couple things popped in mind, which I think is important to state. When I voted against a teacher contract, one of the main reasons I voted against it was I didn't like the way one of the clauses in there that the only clause that the board actually advocated for that was eventually, I think, part of the teacher contract eventually that was approved was that we went from, if you're going to get health insurance, it went from 0.5 to 0.6. I think we stated that was going to save us $250,000 or something. And I voted against it because I thought those, I think there were, if I recall, about 20 people maybe were going to be impacted by that, and I thought that was a very fair thing to have people that were going to be basically taking a $12,000 pay cut because they had 0.5, and I thought that was very unfair. And I stated that at the time. That was probably one of two reasons I objected to the teacher contract, and I didn't vote against it. Looking at this, I'm very happy to see that there was quite a few people that were 0.5 that got up to 0.6, and I read we had 11, and I'm very thankful for that because the people that could have been very negatively impacted were not. And I'm very thankful for that because these people otherwise would have obviously had to quit the job. Maybe people couldn't afford a $13,000 pay cut, effective pay cut. But it does bring up a fact that when we negotiated, that was the only thing our negotiators said that we got. We got nothing else. We gave more pay raises. There's a couple other items. This was the only thing that was accepted. Now it turns out the negative thing here, I mean the positive thing, is that these people are going to keep their health insurance and will probably continue being employees, and thank goodness for that because we need them. The negative thing is here is that the only thing that we got on the negotiation that we got from the teachers was this thing, and now we don't have that anymore. And now it's going to cost us another, whatever it is, $200,000, or I'm guessing on that, because that clause was no longer there. I'm just pointing that out. Again, I'm obviously going to support this because these people should not have been, because they only had 0.5, they lost their, $12,000-$13,000 health insurance, so I'm very glad of that. But I'm pointing out here that I think the board is very inconsistent here, that we did this thinking that we were supposed to save something and that the savings is going to be very non-existent. In this case, I'm very glad because these people should not have lost their health insurance because they had a 0.5 thing after they had had that for so many years. So that was the point I wanted to make.
Members, Mr. Swirsky?
I just want to point out these were not arbitrarily raised to 0.6 as to keep them with insurance. There were logistical reasons for that. Some of these reasons are the increase in the high school day by the additional 9 minutes per day. Some of these could have been other positions that were vacant. Knowing that they would not have insurance, they bid on higher FTE jobs in order to secure insurance for themselves. So. I just want to say these are purposeful increases, not arbitrary in terms of trying to give somebody insurance. That would take away the argument of the $200,000.
Member Johnston.
I wasn't saying they were randomly done. I think being purposeful in this case was a very good thing, and I'm very proud of hearing that those people got that for whatever reason. That should not have happened to them. And what I think I'd be proud to say that this was purposefully done that way. I don't think that's a bad thing to admit. But again, I do think that this certainly is going to decrease the amount of money that we saved. Again, I thought it was a very poor savings in the first place by going on the back of usually the lowest paid employees already in the district. Again, I'm just pointing out the hypocrisy of this, and it's. To me, it's kind of concerning the way this worked out. Had another question on that. Obviously, I'm not going to vote against this at all, but I did. This is maybe this is out of order, Mr. Chair. If you think I should hold this for later, I can. But
is it to the HR?
Yes, vote? I think it has to do with our staff.
If it's relating to the HR report, feel free.
Yeah, it does. Well, I'm not quite sure it does, but I'll take your advice on this. One, we have to bring up that it was an article in the paper, and I can hold this, that there was a lot of Piedmont teachers. There was a concern there. And again, I was told by several people in Piedmont and elsewhere that 60% of the teachers applied for other jobs in Piedmont. Again, it just seems like a real important issue here and what's going on in HR. Again, I know it's not quite part of this. I can hold this for later on in the meeting when we have other questions, if you would prefer.
Point of information on that. I think that is a separate item, and we certainly have time for discussion on that at another time.
Okay, I got one other maybe questionable thing, too, was I know we were told here, I think, back in the May committee meeting that we're expecting about 40 teachers to retire. And again, are we now expecting to hire 40 teachers next fall, which I certainly hope we are, and in addition to the, I think it was 13 teachers that we were saying that we're going to put according to the referendum that passed. So that was a question I had, and I can hold that till later, too. It isn't quite part of this, but certainly a very important part of how we deal with our HR people.
I think we can have Mr. Swirsky answer that one.
This year, as you've seen on the reports that were in front of you, we had no layoffs, very few. The other one was just a long-term sub. It's kind of a neutral year with the $1.6 million added. That's approximately, you know, 15, 16, 17 teachers that are being added to the rolls. So if you look at on this report, these certified appointments, these are new individuals to the district. These are not existing staff members. So, yes, will they be replaced piece by piece, you know, person for person? Not necessarily, but overall it's going to be a wash this year with us bringing in. My guess is we're going to probably hire about 7 to 8 new elementary teachers new to the district. Not so many new positions at the secondary because there was kind of more of a push there, but at the elementary, we will have about 7 or 8 new teachers to the district. And there are a number of new teachers in here to the special education area.
Member Loeffler Kemp.
Okay, I just want to clarify, we can respond to any item on the Human Resource Committee? I just want to clarify that.
If you want to pull and discuss, you may.
Okay.
I think Mr. Johnson is still carrying this one forward, okay. And when he's through, then we can go to you or anyone else who wants to.
I just had a comment on another part of it, and I just wasn't
clear
where
we're
at. Sorry.
Right. Mr. Johnson. Member Johnston.
Mr. is fine. It is my birthday, so I think it's a happy birthday, too. Thank you, Jane, for reminding people that. For me. I'll answer to anything, obviously. The question that really wasn't quite what I asked, I don't think, is I know you stated, and I know we've had retirement, and we had a retirement thing, which unfortunately was out of town in mountains of Nevada when that was going on, so I missed that to give honor to the teachers that are retiring. But it was indicated that we had about 40 retirees, and I'm hoping you will say, and I don't know if you can or not, maybe you can't, but I'm hoping that we are going to be hiring 40 new teachers, young teachers coming in, wherever it may be. I don't know where they're retiring, if it's elementary, high school, doesn't matter to me. But if we retired 40 people, I certainly hope that we're going to replace 40, plus the 15 you mentioned that we were expecting to hire. So can we expect, I don't know when, but before next school starts, that we're going to hire 55 new teachers in the district, which I think would be really cool and hope that we can.
Well, again, as you can see, there's 19 on this schedule, and I would anticipate seeing hires throughout the summer months, right up into the time school starts. This year, based on where we are with enrollments, based on where we were with our budgets, it's going to be pretty much a wash. We should be actually increasing our teachers versus decreasing. So,
thank you. Anybody want to pull anything else on this? Member Johnston.
I think you're saying we are going to replace these, and I'm hoping that's what you're saying. I didn't quite get your answer, but I'm going to stake it that yes, we are going to be replacing those people that retired in addition to the 15. So If I'm wrong on that, Mr. Gronsov, correct me later here, but I certainly hope that's the case.
Okay. I see no other lights. All in favor of the Human Resources Committee report signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It passes 7-0. Thank you, Member Welty. We now move on to the Business Committee report. Member Loeffler Kemp.
Thank you, Chair Murnicky. And again, we are on at the front page of the Business Committee. And again, as always at our Business Committee meetings, there's a lot of material that's presented and discussion and many great questions to our staff. And I want to make a motion to approve the Business Committee. Number one is a financial report, and it's the usual monthly reports that we receive. Budget revisions, wire transfers, investment transactions, WADM projections, and again, that's weighted average daily membership, fundraisers, investments in school children. And just note on page 36, again, there were a number of organizations and individuals that made donations both to academic and athletic opportunities here in our school, and I just like to note that support. And then two bids, RFPs, and quote reports. And at this time, again, there were two bids, and it's recommended that we accept both. One is for bid 1233, and that's for our child nutrition, going with Kemp's. And I just want to mention that's no relationship to me. And then also bid 1234, the recommended, again, in the child nutrition department for Domino's Pizza. And I appreciated just the number of different vendors the bids were sent out to. The next section, RFPs, had to do with vehicle fuel requirements, and again, that is recommended that we approve a contract with Holiday Station Stores. And do you want me just to continue on?
Just keep,
okay,
yep.
Great. Okay, quotes. The first one is quote 4164, district-wide carpentry labor. And that is recommended that we go with Donald Home Construction Company, which is a local union company. Quote 4166, disposable air filters, and that is recommended that we approve that. And as noted in our committee meeting, it's great to have healthy schools with our new buildings and the air filters. Number three, then, policies and regulations. And policy 9070 concerning regular meetings, it's recommended that the Duluth School Board review and approve the changes to bylaw 9070 for the second reading. And then bylaw 9100 special meetings. Again, it's recommended that the Duluth School Board review approve changes to bylaw 9100 for the second reading. And then under section, under contracts, changeovers, and leases, the first contracts has to do with Duluth Heritage Sports Center renewal, and it's recommended that the Duluth School Board approve renewing the contract with the Duluth Heritage Sports Center. Number two is PEIP insurance renewal, which is the Minnesota Public Employees Insurance Program, and recommended that the Duluth School Board approve the PEIP renewal and authorize the board chair to sign the final documents. Number three, health and safety training contract, and that is recommended that the Duluth School Board approve entering a contract with APEC Online Development, LLC, for consulting services related to the web-based safety training. And thank you, Mr. Leiter, for letting me know what other school clients this company has across the state. And then the next one has to do with leases, and Northwoods Children's Home lease renewal. It's recommended that the Duluth School Board approve the lease renewal with Northwood Children's Home, Chester Creek Academy. On the following page, do you want me to?
Thank you. For the resolutions, let's go one at a time, and then we can go back to the regular business report. So maybe we can start off with B614.
Okay. And for the audience, this is on page 70. Okay. Resolution B614-3190, authorized student activity bank account signer. Resolved by the School Board of Independent School District number 709, St. Louis County, Minnesota, that it hereby authorizes the following removal of authorized signatures at Piedmont and at Woodland Hills. Do you want me to be more specific there?
I think that stands. Yes, it stands. You move that?
So I move that.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Member Westholm. Discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. 3191, if you would.
Sure. And then this is resolution B614-3191, Minnesota State High School League membership. On page 71, and it's recommended that the Duluth School Board approve this resolution to our membership to the Minnesota State High School League, and that's both for Denfeld and East High School. And I move that we approve this resolution.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Member Westholm. Discussion? Member Johnston?
Didn't I see somewhere in here that the cost is about $2,500? I don't see that here now, but where was that? Was that in?
We received that.
Okay. Yeah, it's okay. I've seen it somewhere. Again, I'm not going to vote against this, but again, I want to say here that $2,800. Yep, okay. So about $2,800 for each school, so $5,800 apiece. Again, I've heard a lot of... we talked about this at the committee meeting. I just want to express here again the impact is going to be that Denfeld and East can play together in football. And I've actually got quite a few concerns or calls on that or emails on that, I guess. And I know I'm not going to vote against this, but I know Mr. Murnicki and I talked about this, and we don't think it's a very good deal. I just wish that somehow this could have been done better. Maybe one way would be to balance out the number of students between East and Denfeld. So that's the thing that, of course, that all of us West Duluth people are very interested in. So I just want to make those comments, and even though I will be voting no, it's kind of a... I'm not real proud of voting no to give them more money, which I don't think was really a fair deal to happen to Duluth.
I'm a Denfeld grad, and coach of Denfeld right now, Frank Huey, is a Denfeld grad. And Frank Huey even said, I feel sorry for East. This doesn't go into effect next year, which will confuse some people. They will play each other next year. It goes into effect the following year. And if... we can figure out a way to balance the populations, and that's a sticky wicket, as they say. We may be able to. I don't know. It might be too late. We may have to be forced to go with that for 2 years. But you're at the mercy of the Minnesota State High School League. If you join, you play by their rules. So.
Well, and I appreciate, Chair Murnicki, you're serving on that for our school board, and we know that this deals with many of our athletics beyond just football.
Yeah.
Across the district.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded for resolution B614-3191. All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, no. Okay. 3192.
Okay, resolution B614-3192, adoption of the fiscal year 2015 budget. Again, that's on page 72. And it's recommended that the Duluth School Board approve resolution B614-3192, adoption of the budget, and on June 17th, 2014.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Member Westholm. Discussion, we start, Member Welty.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We did, as a board at the business committee meeting, get a look at a larger version than this one sheet, which is sort of a summary of changes on page 73 for those of you in the audience who are following this. I have to tell you that I do not feel that the question that I asked at that time has been answered. Things look good for perhaps next year. We've talked about a surplus for a change, but I'm still quite anxious about a document that the business office gave us in January, projecting a $13.7 million deficit for the 17-18 school year. I know that we're going to get about a quarter million a year more from the legislature, but I also know that we're expecting that there'll be about $2.4 million in additional increases in salary and benefits costs, so that I anticipate that $13.7 million deficit will be a $15.1 million deficit. And I have not yet been satisfied with any of the answers that have been given to me how we can avoid moving into a huge deficit about the time I will be asking voters to consider possibly re-electing me to the board. And in the absence of those answers, I cannot in good conscience vote for this.
Thank you. Member Johnston.
A couple of comments I want to have here. Several months ago, I asked for some detailed information on the budget. I said, well, we can't get that because we don't really know what the budget is yet, so this is too preliminary. We can't give you these answers. I was asking things about, like, what the unrestricted reserve fund was and those kind of questions. I was never given an answer. I've asked for that now. I do have a follow-up question on that, which I'll ask. But more specifically, I asked quite a few questions. I've asked, what are the budgets between the schools? I've asked about the Title I money budgets. I've got nothing. Luckily, we did here just a week ago. They did finally give us more than our one-page handout that we were given that we had to approve without knowing anything. And suddenly this appeared out of nowhere, and which I do appreciate. But this is what I was asking for 3 months ago, a draft on this. Of course, we know it's a draft, and I thought that I was stonewalled completely. I think I was even ridiculed when I asked, like, well, how can you ask that? We don't know that. Well, no, we have a draft in front of us, and I think that it's important to say that I still don't have the information I want. I want to know what the budgets for each individual schools are. As a school board member, particularly when we have the concern we've got on Denfeld and East, I want to know that. Me as a school board member has a right to know before we pass a budget where that money is going to go. Now, I'm not saying there's anything wrong done. We know we have a student imbalance for sure, but I want to know where the money went. And to me, this is not good enough. I want to know that. I want to know what the Title I money, I want to know how that was split up between the schools. Those are very simple questions that a school board member, I think, is supposed to be asking, and I'm going to ask that. I'm going to keep asking it. I don't suspect I'll ever get it. I think it's kind of sad that we're passing a budget here now and I don't even know how much money is going to Denfeld, how much is going to East. People in Duluth want to know. So I will be voting against this as well. I do have a specific question, and then I'll on that. This concerns that we talked a little bit about, I think it was on page 2, I believe it was page 2, or was it page 2? Going back to last year's audit, we had information given out on the audit, and we were told that the unrestricted general fund was $1.2 million. That had been decreased from 2.9 in fiscal year 12. So last year we had a 1.8 reduction in that. Now, I don't think this number is on here, so I'm asking, I want to compare apples to apples. What is a projected unrestricted fund. Did it go from $1.2 million up to what? I'd like to know what that's projected. There's all kinds of fund balances, which is not the same as unrestricted fund balance, which is how we're looking at how close are we doing when it comes to statutory operating debt. And am I missing something here? Certainly correct me if this is somewhere on the page, but I don't see it. I don't see a change from last year of $1.2 million and what it is this year. And if it's not on there, what is it?
Mr. Hansen.
Thank you. I don't recall a number of $1.2 million, Member Johnston. The number that we ended up the year at for our general fund balance is the number on the far right column. It's the second number from the bottom. This is on page 2 of the budget package. $1,934,777. The number that we're projecting for as an increment, as we discussed at the committee meeting, for this current fiscal year 14 is an increase of $4.4 million, which again added to the 1.9 would bring our projected fund balance, and we're a long ways from knowing that number in actuality, of course, but that would bring us to a total of $6.3 million in fund balance at the end of 6/30/14. If you, the budget as presented to you will create a surplus, again, in the general fund of $3.2 million for fiscal year 15, bringing the projected fund balance at 6/30/15. This is, again, on the far right column. This is the bottom number on that column to $9.6 million of fund balance at the end of 6/30/15.
No, that's not the question I'm asking. I'm asking, which I have the document here if you want to take a look at it. I think it's in Mr. LeBlanc's handwriting, that we had an unrestricted fund balance. I'm not talking about the general fund balance. I'm talking about the unrestricted fund balance. And this is what I have off the audit from last year that I was told was $1.2 million. And I was told that the numbers on the audit were not what's unrestricted fund balance, and so that I'm trying to find out. If nobody knows what that is, I will hold on to that and bring it up in the audit again at the end of the year. But I don't think that these numbers are what's called the unrestricted fund balance, which is how we define statutory operating debt. These are not the numbers. Otherwise, if they are, I was told wrong information last fall on my sheet here. And I'm trying to compare apples to apples, and at this point I don't think we are. And apparently nobody is going to respond to that, and I will keep asking that question until I find out what the projected unrestricted fund balance is, because the numbers that you have on this page do not agree with the numbers that were in the audit last fall and about what the actual unrestricted fund balance actually is. Because that wasn't on the audit. I had to ask for it. I had to ask for it about 5 times. I finally got it, and I'm asking for the same number. Hopefully I won't have to ask 5 times to get it again. Since I'm not going to get it, I'll go on to my next question. Let's see. I will hold off on my question.
I just wanted to note 3 items from here that we talked about when we were advocating for the levy to pass: the additional teachers to reduce class size, the additional investment in curriculum materials, and investment in the student achievement gap. So just want to make sure that that's on the record and appreciate that. And then I also remember from initial conversations that we had held, was it? And Mr. Hansen, help me remember, I don't know if it was 6 or 8% that we were holding aside for PEEP, and it only went up by 1.7%. So I know that you, in budget projections, made sure to hold a significant amount just in case there was a large increase, but I appreciate knowing that it's just a 1.7 increase. You had that idea, but I appreciate you being conservative in that way. Thank you.
Member Loeffler-Kim.
Yeah, couple comments. I was going to make a similar comment as Member Harla did about our budget reflecting the goals of the referendum with a focus on teachers' curriculum and the achievement gap. It also reflects the Think Kids meetings that we had this winter, and we went across the school district and allowed got much input from community members, parents, school staff across the district, and one of the budget or the forms that we spent a lot of time with at these meetings was on draft budget considerations and investments. And so just I want to make sure the public understands that we as a school board have had a number of meetings. I have a whole file here of the dates when we've met to look at the budget, look at these considerations, hear input. We also in March at our meeting, we looked again at the budget investments and considerations, and that was put out to the public. So I guess I just want to note that this process has been ongoing in terms of educating us as well as allowing us to ask questions since January. And I want to also thank our finance folks, Mr. Hansen and Mr. LeBlanc, for providing the information to help us make this informed decision tonight. Thank you.
Member Johnston.
I don't think we have been informed. I've been vocal about this. And the odd thing that I find is that nobody ever wants to answer my questions. Oh, what was the split between Denfeld and East, for example? Oh, we had a great meeting, but we never answered those questions. Again, I would feel happy if some of these questions was at least an attempt to answer. I want to say again that the Think Kids thing was not a budget meeting. When I was at, we handed out the same one-page paper that Member Welty and I had been asking for more information on along. So let's be clear here that there have been certainly board members that have not been happy about this. And the board makes these determinations, not the Think Kids. I want to say I'm going to end up in what I think is a positive note. I hope that we have a surplus this year. Hope that we can increase our fund balance, and I think that is good. And I said this at the committee meeting. I'm going to say it again. And maybe Member Welty and I will disagree on this item, but I think it's very important to have a discussion. Is that I would rather have money go into teachers and increasing our curriculum than to building up our fund balance. I think it is just unconscionable that we've gotten to the point that last year we only had $1.2 million unrestricted fund balance. We should have never got to that stage. I think it's almost unconscionable. But now that we're there, we have the choice as a board, and I'd like to have that discussion. We have not had it. Are we going to build up that fund balance for a rainy day? Are we going to put it into curriculum and teachers? I think that we as a board should be putting this into curriculum and teachers. I know, and I want to have this discussion, and it's not that Mr. Welty and I are maybe disagreeing, is that if we have this, I'm hoping that we don't have a reduction in students. I still want to, my goal is to have 9,000 students in this school. And doing that, we can't do it by, I think we're in a downward spiral. We have to somehow take a chance in breaking through that. And rather than putting, I think Mr. Hansen said we're putting about $4.4 million into the fund balance. I wish that that was good, but I think it's more important that we put money into teaching now and not the fund balance, because I think we're at a critical state in our district. We have to take a chance. I think it's an important chance. And again, this will be passing, obviously, with 5-2. We all know that. But I think that the board is not doing their due diligence by having very serious discussions that should money be going to fund balances or should money be going to teachers. And my personal thing is that I would like to have that money going to teachers and curriculum. I think it's absolutely critical to get our students back. And so I will be voting against it for that reason, as well as the lack of preparation and answering that I've been asking for all along.
That's fine.
Member Welty.
Yes, I do share Member Johnson's concerns about the information that we as a school board are presented, and I have been unnerved about that really for the last 6 months, and I expect that may continue for the next year and a half. But I would like to address the question that you just asked, Mr. Johnson, because I've done some thinking about it, and that is the old policy that was instituted when I was in the school board, that the school district maintain a 10% reserve. I was very proud of that. Over the years, I've taken my little apple and I polished it on my shirt to tell everybody what a prudent person I was. But that was a different era. And one of the things that was available to this school district in those flush times when interest rates were going up was the opportunity to take the 10% reserve and other reserves that we have and invest them. And we were getting frequently 10% on the dollar. That meant that if we did not spend those reserves, we were earning close to $1 million a year that we could then put into programming. Well, those days are gone, and I would no longer encourage this school board to try to set aside the 10% reserve. My concern is that the document that I've been looking at mentions SOD, statutory operating debt, the death knell for any school district, because it basically suggests that bankruptcy is looming. I would point out that we've been taking about $6 million out of operations for about 4 years running, and the thing that really has allowed us not to have to do that now is the fact that the very generous one-time only Democratic legislature of the last session gave us $4 million, and then our voters last year gave us $1.8 million. That has allowed us not to transfer money out of operations to pay off our accumulating or accumulated debt for the long-range facilities plan. I still have an awful lot of questions about the budget. Somehow it doesn't seem that it should be so complicated. I served on the board for 8 years, dealt with people that I thought explained things to me pretty well. Maybe things have changed so radically that, or maybe I've aged and become so decrepit, and that explains why I have such huge questions about where we're headed financially. But I am concerned, and my concerns have not been arrested. So it will be a big challenge for our business department to explain things to a mentally slow old man on this board to allay my fears.
Member Johnston.
Well, I will stand up for Mr. Welty. I don't think you're old. I think your questions are legitimate. I know you're trying to be nice and saying that it's all your problem, not the administration's problem here, but I must say that, no, it's not your problem, Mr. Welty. It's the administration's problem.
Let's vote. All in favor of the resolution B614-3192, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Is that a 2-5-2? Thank you. Member Loeffler-Kemp, if you would.
Sure.
3193.
Okay, again, this is on page 74, resolution B614-3193, approving the 10-year capital facilities plan, and this is an update as well. It's recommended that the Duluth School Board approve resolution B614-3193, and let me see here. It is broken down as well by school, and I would like to move this resolution.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Member Westholm. Seeing no discussion, we'll vote. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, that passed.
Okay, and then the last is informational, and these items are provided for informational purposes. So expenditure contracts, there's a list of them on page 90. Revenue contracts on page 202. Note on that one, it does talk about St. Michael's School and Harbor City for their meal program that we contract with. Page 211, other contracts, and then Page 219, Facilities Management and Capital Project Status Report, which is provided to us each month as well.
Move the report.
And so I move the business report.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Member Harla. Discussion. Member Welty.
I'd like to withdraw for discussion item 3-2.
3-2?
3-A-2.
3-A-2.
I have another one.
Sure.
I'd also like to withdraw for discussion 4-A-2.
4-A-2. Any others? Okay. Member Johnston.
I'd like to pull up for discussion 1F.
Okay, no, it's just 1F.
I'd like to pull out for vote all of item 2A.
All of item 2A.
And I'd also like to ask for a vote for 3A1.
You want to pull that for discussion, or you want to pull a vote?
Vote and 3A2, I'd like to have a vote for that one, too, if I could add that to Member Welty's request. I'd like to have a vote on 4A.
Oh, 4A.
Yep, and a vote.
To all of them?
Yes. Yes, again, I was going to ask for a vote. I'm going to have almost no discussion, so it will go fast. Oh,
can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Do you want a vote on 4A with the 1, 2, 3 contracts or 4A? Yeah,
that's what I was doing, but Member Welty pulled out 4A2, and I'm not sure what his intent was there. But if
So we can vote on 4A as without... Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I'm fine. Just to make it as fast as possible. I'm lumping these together, but I don't want to have a discussion. I just want to have a vote. But they will be voting against the committee meeting as a whole. I want to vote for some of the ones that I obviously support. And I also like to vote on 4C.
Leases?
Yeah. Again, the votes, I don't think I'm going to, unless somebody else wants to discuss, it's going to be a quick vote, just so,
okay.
Mr. Chair, you know that, and I think I got everything there, I hope.
If it pleases the group, any other, okay, if it pleases the group, can we go in order of these? If that's all right. All right. We'll start with financial report 1F, Wadham. Excuse me for a second, I'm doing about six things here. Mr. Johnson.
Yes, I'm going to bring this up because I always bring it up. I know everybody gets mad at me when I bring it up, and but yet I think it's important to bring up, and I'm going to probably say the same thing I always do, but I guess we've got a new wrinkle on it now, so I'm going to probably add a thing, so hold on to your chair on that one. Again, I want to point out here that when I went through and explained to me what the second column was on the progression ADA, which was, I guess, the projected one. If you go through and add those numbers up, we're at 8350. If we go and look at the handout that came out with our budget, this handout that we got on the committee meeting, it had expected enrollment. We're down to 8330, I believe it is. And again, I'm pointing out there again, we broke the record again, folks. We are now at the lowest number of students we've had in Duluth School. I don't know for how long, probably since 1900, probably for 100 years. And whenever I bring this up, people say, well, everybody is having that problem. Well, Minnesota, they also have a decrease. Well, let's get some facts, and this is important because I think this is absolutely critical to what we're doing. We've lost 1,300 students since I've been elected on the school board. 1,300. In 18 years, which is far back as AMDE has their records on the web, we've lost 5,700 students. 5,700. In other words, we've had a decrease of over 40%. me this is just not acceptable. We're now the 22nd largest school, down from 9 only 18 years ago, and the records are available on the web. In that time, Minnesota has had an increase of 3% in student population. This is according to MBE. It's not been a decrease, as some of the board members claimed and as the superintendent has claimed. Neighboring school districts, Proctor has had about a 20% decrease. Hermantown, Renshaw, Cloquet, and Esco have had all increases in that same time. So this is very specific for Duluth Public Schools. There's maybe lots of reasons for that, but I think that we as a board is responsible. I think the administration is responsible for these. And unfortunately, Member Welty mentioned the projected $13 million deficit here in 4 years' time. That projection was based on one of the things that we had 8,100 students, if I recall, from seeing the spreadsheet projected on the wall. Looks like we're probably getting there. And to me, that very concerns me. I'm going to bring this up every meeting because it does concern me. And it's something that I've heard other members say, well, gee, this is really good because we've been projecting this. This is not really good. We have lost way too many students. It's not acceptable. This community can't do it. We've just invested $320 million, and we are still losing students. And I will end off my normal thing, which everybody's heard many times. But again, a member asked when I did this last time, well, gee, I'm kind of tired of you always bringing this up. Why don't you give them some solutions? I was hesitant to say that, but I think I will today. The solutions are, one, maybe we could even act civil to each other. Remind people of a week ago what happened to me. I think that I'm just the last of many people that this has happened to. The legacy, I think, of this administration is, since I've been in the last 2 years, we've fired, okay, that's not quite the right word, got rid of many people, which has caused a lot of angst in our community, from a superintendent to a principal to coaches and who knows how many more that I've forgot. I'm the latest line on that. Everybody talks about civility. I can't wait till we get to the civility thing here. And why have we lost students? We've lost students because this administration is not civil. This board is not civil. And I have went and heard this over and over again from parents that me, a school board member, is being treated this way. What, imagine yourself as being a disenfranchised economic group or a community of color. That is what's happening, and that is why we have a decrease in population. I was hoping that we would be getting along better and that we would make people proud to want to come back to our schools. What are we doing? Thank you for asking me that question. My answer is the answer why we have a decreasing is sitting right here at this front table and some of the suits in the back. And I'm asking again, if we don't change the way we do business, we will be down to that 8,100. We will be down to that $13 million deficit. And I don't think that's acceptable. Yeah, I take it kind of personally when I'm being attacked by the board. And it is an attack, and it's an assault, actually. I guess we as a school board is redefining what assault means. But the reality is that this is, it's hurting me. But the reality is it's hurting this whole town. It's hurting our students. It's hurting why people want to come back here. And I can't wait to hear the justification and why I'm wrong on this one. But all I'm doing is asking if we want to change this, we have to start right here. And I'm asking for this board to start changing now.
Member Loeffler-Kemp.
Yeah, I just, being the conversation was on the Wadham report on page 34, I just wanted to give Mr. Hansen an opportunity if there's anything you want to point out that was important with this Wadham report. Thank you.
I don't have last month's number right in front of me, but I think we're up about 40 Wadhams in terms of what we're projecting, 40 higher than we were last month. So that's a piece of good news.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Do you want to hit your light off? Yeah, thanks. Okay. Member Johnston.
Sure, I want to keep reminding people here that I'm looking at the real numbers. It's great that we lowered the projection down. The numbers are down lower at the lowest we've ever been this year ever in, what, 100 years, and that's the number that I'm looking at, not what some projection was. We got to project that we're being positive, and we're not doing that. I want 9,000 students in this school. By the time I get off this board, and I'm expecting that the administration carry out that.
Okay, Member Johnston, 2A, is it 1 and 2? You want to do both bids? Wait 1 second, I've got a... There it is. Okay.
John.
Oh, I was just asking for a vote. I have no discussion. I just wanted to vote on it.
You want to vote on these bids, a separate vote?
Yeah.
Okay. I want to make sure I'm doing this correctly. This is just the bids, the dairy and the pizza. Okay. All in favor of the bids, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It was a 6-0 vote. Okay, and now we go down to 3A1, Mr. Johnston.
This is our regular meeting. We had a discussion. I'll make it short. I'm going to move again that we amend this by changing 3 to 2.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we amend bylaw 97 to change the number from 3 to 2. Member Welty.
Yes, I did pull the second portion that related to policy 9100. I made all my arguments at the last meeting when I said that as a member of a two-member minority, I appreciated to have the opportunity, as we had them in the bylaws as they currently exist and are about to be changed, to have at least two people call a special meeting. It's not something that I think has been done, even though it's been available to school board members to do. But now I'm facing the possibility of being a one-member minority at some point in the future. So even if it was two, I might be unable to call a special committee meeting because we're moving it up to three. I think that all the arguments that I made about giving a minority in the school board a chance to have a public discussion of important matters is a good idea. I much prefer the old language of two. It suited the school board in the past when it was rarely used. And so while I was going to make the same motion pertaining to 9100, I'm quite happy to make this motion regarding the regular meetings.
Okay, Member Johnston.
To say it again, this is the same situation on the agenda. This majority members are not being listened to. We are not given a chance to say. This again codifies again in our bylaws that to make sure these minority members are not going to be listened to, make sure they have no participation in setting the agenda, make sure they have no participating in setting special meetings, and that's not civility. And again, I can't wait to talk about the civility code when we get to that.
I'd like to comment again that a number of districts use this formula. It's standard in many places, and we, and I know I'm going to open myself up for this, but we have freedom of speech. We can speak at committee meetings, we can speak at board meetings. As you can see tonight, we can speak at board meetings. You can disagree with me. It's just my point. I don't think this is violating anybody's freedom of speech. Member Loeffler Kemp.
Yeah, just being this is my business committee report, I just want to mention that for both bylaw 97 and bylaw 9100, this is a second reading. So this has been discussed at a couple committee meetings now and the past board meeting, and so I just want the public to know there's been a lot of discussion on both of these. Thank you.
Member Johnston.
This is not a question of freedom of speech, and I mean, I can't believe you said that. I happen to be a participant in a school board. This is not about my writing a column in the paper. Of course I'll keep doing that. I'm right about me participating as a minority member in this school board, in this school. You're saying it's a freedom of speech? No, it's about me as a minority board member who has a right through Robert's Rules of Order, not the Civility Code, that I have a right to be heard, and you're denying that.
Member Welty.
I guess my comment on this would be that this is not an earth-shaking change, but it's symbolic, and I think especially in light of what has transpired since I first argued that we allow two people to have the right to call a special committee meeting, I think that the symbolism is all the more potent. And I was going to make the same motion regarding 9100, but I think the vote on 9070 will tell, and if it goes down to defeat and demonstrate the symbolism that I'm afraid will be demonstrated, I won't bother trying to amend 9100, which is, I think, the more practical policy for me to try to change.
Okay. We're voting on the amendment to reduce bylaw 9070 from 3 to 2. If you're in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Nay.
Nay.
Nay. Okay, we're voting. We can re-vote then. All right. This is the amendment offered by Member Johnson, seconded by Member Welty, to reduce the number from 3 to 2. Okay, let's re-vote again. Are we good on this? Okay. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Nay. Nay. It does not pass. We now go to vote on the bylaw. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
4 to 2. Okay. I'm sorry? Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sorry. Yeah. So it's 4 to 2.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Member Welty, we go to 9100.
I have nothing to say. I think the board will do the same thing, and I see a little point in talking about symbolism under the circumstances. I've already made my comments.
Okay, Member Johnston.
I'll make a motion to change to delete 2 and add 3.
Second.
I think you meant delete 3 and add 2. Okay. Okay, it's moved and seconded to delete the number 3 and add number 2. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Nay. Let's vote on the bylaw. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
And 5 to 2. Okay, Member Johnson, 4A. Or again, Member Welty, you have 4A2. Can we consider the 3 of these as a packet and have both? No? Okay, let's go one at a time. Member Johnson, 4A, Heritage.
Mr. Welty's comments, again, I don't have a lot of comments on these, so depending on what he says, we may be able to go to a vote, but maybe not. So that's okay with you. And
excuse me, I'm just really confused, and I apologize. You're pulling 4A1 to discuss, or...
No.
I have to vote on
something. Oh, okay. So you don't want to discuss Heritage?
Well, how about I wasn't going to discuss it, no, but Member Welty has pulled 4A2, and that's obviously, he has to have a discussion, so okay. I don't want to vote on this without okay. giving Member Welty that discussion opportunity.
Member Welty, do you want to discuss the PEEP insurance renewal?
Yes. I will preface my comments by saying that this has been a change since I was on the school board 10 years ago. And the state has intervened where the employees of school districts are concerned and set up this entity, PEEP. And I have talked to a few people about it. I have the beginning of an understanding about it, but it's pretty minuscule. It's part of the dotage that I've been apologizing for. I do have one question, since we are being asked to approve this contract, and as Member Harla noted, an increase in the cost that could have been as high as 6%, I think was like 1.5%, which is one of the things that has been a boon to us in terms of shaving some costs off of our current budget. But I'm asking this question for somebody who knows a lot more than me and who I kind of wish was sitting where I am now, but it's a question they wrote out. I would like to know who the primary care clinic is for the district for our employees under PEEP to begin with.
Would that be Mr. LeBlanc? Or, okay. Mr. Hansen.
It is it's a decision that each employee has to declare yeah. a primary care clinic for themselves, and then they operate within that clinic. It's part of how the plan operates.
Okay. How about the cost levels for employees? Is it vary in the same way that they can go to different care clinics, or is there a standard rate of cost?
I'll answer in the way I think you're asking the question, so bear with me. There are different cost levels for each network, so different clinics can be at different cost levels, and that does impact the ultimate benefit that that the employee will receive.
So in other words, to get that information, we would have to be looking at several different schedules for each of the clinics for the procedures and that they cover?
Not so much about the procedure, but about the clinic network.
The clinic network. Okay. How about out-of-pocket costs? How are those determined?
That's part of the overall PEEP plan document.
And those costs are determined by the primary care clinic, or are they part of the PEEP agreement? I will add that I probably won't understand what you're telling me, because, as I've said before, the PEEP is a big mystery to me. But I'm kind of asking this for somebody else who's looking for this data.
Right. The out-of-pocket expenses are declared by the network that each employee is part of, and then again, how you get to those numbers is also determined as part of that group, because it's part of it, you know, the deductible and the copay and et cetera.
Do we have any comparisons between our costs as we are experiencing them now under PEEP and what they might have been before PEEP was established? Even though it's been several years, there'd be cost of living increases. I would be curious to have some sort of a comparison.
Well, I can share with you that, I mean, certainly when we were in our previous environment, to see increases on an annual basis from 10 to 16% was a pretty normal range of what we saw in terms of increases from year to year. We've not seen that with PEEP. That's been Certainly, in part, it's because we are part of a group of other school districts, as you mentioned, Member Welty. That helps to spread our risk out amongst a larger pool. But our increase is that we've actually had a couple of decreases since we've joined. And this year at 1.7% is, again, we've been more years than not, we've been under the amount that we have allowed for in our initial budgeting.
And one other question that occurs to me, do we have the ability when we negotiate to try to negotiate down lesser out-of-pocket costs and things of that sort, or is there something in PEEP that determines or limits our ability to negotiate that with our bargaining units?
The district's contribution to the HRA is something that is negotiated.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything more on 4A, 1, 2, 3? Okay, we go to C1. Member Johnston. Do you want a separate vote, or can we do it as a package?
I actually wanted a separate vote for 4A.
Okay, we'll do that. Let's do that. This is 4A change orders and leases, contracts, Duluth Heritage Center renewal, PEEP, and health and safety training contract. All in favor of this signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It passes 7-0. Okay. Member Johnston.
Just 4C1 or 4C, I was just asking for a vote on that as well.
On the Northwoods home lease.
Yeah, I could have asked for a vote on all four, I guess.
Okay. That was my mistake. Okay, Northwoods Children's Home lease renewal. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? I see that as 7-0. I see no more polls, so let us vote on the business committee as a whole. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
6-1. Member Johnston. Thank you, Ms. Loeffler-Kemp.
Thank you.
Okay. Now, special resolutions. We have a resolution, SP 614-3189. Member Loeffler-Kemp, would you like to make a motion?
Yes, I would. And I want to thank again Anita Stetch and Rob Kerwith, who spoke on this earlier. And again, this is a school board reaffirmation of something past school boards passed. Accepting the 9 tools of civility. Whereas in March 2012, the School Board of Independent School District Number 709 reaffirmed their acceptance of the 9 tools of civility. And whereas the residents of Independent School District Number 709 continue to place a high value on respect and civility in their lives, and they understand that these characteristics are essential to any healthy community. And whereas the School Board of Independent School District Number 709 supports opportunities for civil discourse and discussion in the community and within the school district. And whereas the School Board of Independent School District Number 709 addresses sometimes controversial issues about which people often feel passionately, which at times leads to uncivil behavior. And whereas an atmosphere of incivility and disrespect can have a damaging effect on the proceedings, on the quality of debate, and on the practice of democracy itself. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the School Board of Independent School District Number 709 continues to recognize the 9 tools of civility that will provide increased opportunity for civil discourse in order to find positive resolutions to the issues that face our communities. These tools include pay attention, listen, be inclusive, don't gossip, show respect, be agreeable, apologize, give constructive criticism, take responsibility. Be it resolved, further resolved that the School Board Independent School District Number 709 shall continue to promote the use and adherence of the 9 tools of civility in conducting the business of the School Board, June 17, 2014. I move we reaffirm the 9 tools of civility.
Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Member Westholm. Member Welty.
Well, first of all, I'm just going to mention that I certainly will be voting for this, as I think I have in the past, because I think this project's been around for quite some time. And I will do it for my own good, because if I did not vote for this, my wife would kill me, which I don't think would be terribly civil of her, but that's how she regards the civility project. There are, of course, a number of different things that get at this. We all grew up with a golden rule: do unto others as you would have them do unto you. As a small child, I thought that made a great deal of sense. I was always looking for some of the disagreeable circumstances when you might find it difficult to do that, but I think it's a generally pretty good rule. I have been frequently, according to people for some time, an adage that is attributed to Jesus in Matthew, and that is, be as wise as a serpent, but as innocent as a dove. Just what one has to do to become as wise as a serpent has puzzled me, but I do think that that makes a great deal of sense too. I frankly have felt that our school board, until very, very recently, was abiding by the 9 points here. Quite proud of the first 5 months of being on this school board. We've had agreeable meetings. We had long discussions. In fact, much of this meeting has been quite similar to that, even though it's obvious that we have not always agreed on everything. But it does trouble me that I'm having to vote for this now at a point in time when I think the question of the school board civility is in some dispute, but I certainly will vote for this.
Member Johnston.
I'm making a motion to table this until next month.
Motion to table. Is there a second? Is there a second? There is no second. We move. You don't need. Okay. Member Welty?
I will table it for an explanation as to why the tabling is wished.
We have to have a second to have a discussion.
I second it.
Okay, thank you. Wait 1 second, I'm catching up here. Okay. Member Johnston?
I'm asking to table this for a couple of reasons. First of all, I didn't know this was on the agenda until I got here. This was not talked about on the committee meeting. It was not in our packets last week. This is fitting on. I didn't even know until it was until I asked Member Harlow, where is this on the agenda? There's another reason and I think that's a legal procedure. We're talking about civil. We're not even following our own procedures on this. This was brought up, was not discussed at the committee meetings. Literally, I did not know about it. And more important is, if we don't table this, I have a lot of discussions. I'm going to have a lot of questions about this. And either we can leave here now at get out of here by 10 o'clock, or somebody can, of course, call a question and get me to shut up so we don't have to talk about civility anymore. So for those reasons, I'm asking this board to table this. I would like to have a discussion. I don't really want to do it at 10 o'clock. If I have to, I will. And I'm asking again, that's why I'm asking this board to table this until next month.
Member Welty.
I expect to be the only other person to go along and vote with you on this, Member Johnston. I think that that's a legitimate point to make. Ultimately, I will vote for this because I you know, whether it's this time or some other time after we've had more discussion. What I find particularly ironic is your noting that somehow this ended up on our agenda, and we've had a lot of discussion about how things end up on an agenda. And noting that long discussion, I guess I would have to say that our policy can miraculously change at times with no particular explanation why it changes if the right combination of people choose for it to change.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor to table. If you want to table it, you vote yes. If you do not, you vote no. All in favor of tabling signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
No.
We now vote on the motion. Member Johnston.
I have the utmost respect for Anita and Rob. I've even went to their meetings. I was very impressed. There's some problems with this. The civility project, it's noble. It's kind of like what I learned in kindergarten type of stuff. I haven't seen Anita or Rob attend any of these meetings. I haven't seen anybody saying, gee, have you been fulfilling these things on the civility project which we passed 2 years ago, or maybe as Member Welty said, 12 years ago. It's really nice to have really nice, happy-sounding stuff, more like what we learned in kindergarten, but if there's no enforcement, you're going to run a meeting with a one piece of paper. I mean, if everything is fine, that's really good, but this is kind of a joke. We have a parliamentary rules of order, which is sitting in that book, which has never opened up, of course. Our bylaws say we follow parliamentary procedure, Robert's Rules of Order, the latest edition, or whatever the verbiage is in our most recent bylaw that was passed, 15 years ago. Never has anybody came to this board to say, were you following the civility project? I don't think this is a laughing matter. If we're going to be passing something, there should be some enforcement on it. There should be some way that we as a board actually follow it. Now, I've seen all these things, as Member Welty so eloquently pointed out, that we pass all these things, and oh, of course I agree on civility, but I think it's been very clear that that civility is as defined by this board as what I want. When somebody else is, oh, I'm the uncivil, somebody even accused me of assault. Two people sitting at this board accused me of assault, which is pure baloney, and it is very painful for me. Mrs. Civil, where was the civility project for the last 2 years? And I'm asking the chair if I can ask Anita some questions.
No, you cannot.
Why?
Because she's not a member of the board right
now. I'm asking here, she presented, I'm asking the board to let me ask her some questions.
No, I'm going to rule that out of order.
Okay. Well, then I will ask the chair then. Okay. I think we've all got this thing. We all know how important this is. Mr. Chair, or anybody else that would care to answer, like maybe Member Sligo Punkle. When I was tried to be arrested 2 years ago, would that pass a civility project code? Either you can answer. Only one of these people that were here were at that meeting, so maybe I'll ask Member Sligo Punkle.
We're not going to have a trial right now, and it wasn't 2 years ago. It was prior
two
to...
2 years ago, before you were on here.
Before I was on the board.
Correctly.
We're just not going to have a question and answer where we're in a court of law right now. So you can make your statement against this resolution,
we're not going to be engaging in any what happened back then and what happened recently.
Well, I think that this is a very important thing. I find
that's
it very
fine.
Telling.
Make a statement.
Yes, I am making a statement, okay, if you didn't notice. And again, nobody even wants to answer any questions. Well, is this ability or not? We have somebody here that could actually answer that. I mean, I would like to know from Anita, and I'm expecting to see this, what has been done in the past to enforce this ability code when these people pass these things. I'd like to get an answer from this ability project. And I will be asking that, I think I deserve an answer for that. What happens when these are violated? Who adjudicates that violation? Does this mean nothing? This means nothing if there is no reinforcement of the principles and if there is no adjudication of the principles that are stated. This means absolutely nothing. It's really easy and cheap to get some nice little glossy handouts to hand out at all the meetings, then come up and blame me for being the uncivil person. We've had this board, and Anita and Rob seen this, we've had this board arrest people and have handcuffed them. And where were you?
Again, I do want to correct that.
It was not this.
Yeah, and a point of order, it was not this board. And I'm done with my point of order.
The point of order is the Duluth School Board, and my point is that the Civility Project sat and did nothing. Absolutely nothing. And I'm kind of, if I were them, I'd be a little ashamed that they are asking us to pass this. I'd be ashamed that if I was a board member asking to pass this, there's no violations, what happens if there's a violation, there's no adjudication. And this isn't worth the paper it's written on, sorry. We have a book there, it was of our parliamentary procedure. I've tried to get people to come into this board, this board, asking about how do we run civil meetings, what are our bylaws, how do we do those, how do we amend bylaws, and I was turned down. Gee, surprise, no surprise there. But yet everybody's jumping on the bandwagon to pass a civility project. Of course this is great. I love all this stuff. But this board violates everything, and so when they go and try to kick me off the board, they're going to have a hard time doing it. Are they going to come up and say, hey, you're not acting civil? I'm waiting for the board to say, gee, board, we're not acting civil. And to me, it's really sad when civility gets relegated to a piece of paper that means nothing. Absolutely nothing. We talk about this resolution, the effect on the proceedings, the quality of the debate, the practice of democracy itself. Those are pretty meaningful things. And you think this piece of paper is going to do that? This board has violated every one of those things, and they think they're going to pass a piece of paper and we're going to improve the practice of democracy and the quality of debate. It's shameful. It's shameful that the Civility Project has done nothing to enforce their own things that they're promoting. It's shameful that board members have actually put this out there without even telling us we're going to do it. This is a shame of democracy. And I think it's sad. Of course, it'll pass. I am going to vote against it because this is a sham. Nothing but a sham. And I'd like to have the people that did these shams in the past, like Member Sligo-Punkel, speak and say something instead of so she can be quoted. I've tried to censor her because of all the mean things she's said, the personal attacks on me only a month ago. Where is this ability?
I think we need to not include personal animosities right now. We can talk about it, the board, in general, if you would.
Well, gee, thank you for not including personal animosities. This board is all personal animosities, and it's just very, very shameful. And I can't believe that this board is sitting here and actually wanting to pass something called the Civility Project. Everybody sits there. Nobody's even going to say anything. The people that have been treated this community very uncivilly, that have tried to arrest people, that have shut out their microphone time after time after time after time, and have destroyed people's lives by firing them. They sit back here. They go, oh, this isn't okay because we passed a civility project. This board isn't civil. I will be voting against it as much as I hate to, because this is a joke. This is a pathetic joke. Until the civility project starts enforcing some of this stuff, adjudicating what's happened here, I will not vote for this. It's not easy enough to say, oh, let's everybody vote for this and be happy.
Member Welty.
First of all, let me just explain that I have a great depth of concern for what has transpired recently, and I can appreciate Member Johnston's comments. I will be voting for this, as I said I would. We are all humans. Humans are deeply flawed. And we frequently don't live up to our ideals. That doesn't mean the ideals are wrong. And while I could nitpick the civility project, their 9 points with some intellectual discussions, I applaud the attempt to help us find our better angels, and I especially hope the school board can find its better angels. But I will be supporting this.
Member Johnston.
I make a motion to amend this by adding point number 10. Be honest and care for other members.
It's been moved and seconded to add a tenth to this. Be honest and care for others. Member Welty.
I do think this, I've thought about this policy over the years, that one of the things it doesn't ask for is honesty. Honesty's often very subjective. And perhaps points 1 through 9, in points 1 through 9, you can find it mentioned indirectly. But I see nothing wrong with adding honesty as point 10. And I would say that the additional verbiage about caring for people is probably in 1 through 9. But since I think we will conclude with this, I would like to show my respect for Mr. Johnson's attempt to round this out just a little bit by encouraging the rest of us to consider voting for his amendment.
Member Johnston?
I think this is important. The civility project is not just something out there in the sky that nobody knows what it is. I think, as Member Westholm said, our harassment policy is something which is evolves. We have to change when new issues come up. I think that I would vote for this if we add this small, very small amendment, which certainly falls exactly in the intent of this. This is what the intent of this is to certainly be honest and care for others. And I'm asking the board to vote for this so I can vote for this. And maybe I would even apologize for my disbelief.
Okay, I'm going to make a statement here. I'm going to vote in favor of this, and I'm going to ask the rest of the members to do so. It's after 10, and the last thing I want to do is stir up any more
Some people think they are the ones that are on the receiving end, and other people think, well, no, they are the ones on the receiving end. And they're locked in their beliefs. It's the other one. It's the other one. It's not me. It's the other one. And honestly, Mr. Welty, I agree with you. It's very subjective. And I look at this board, and I believe that all in all, we're honest people trying to do a good job for the people out there. I think it's important that we reaffirm this. I think it's detrimental to point to one side or the other and say, you're the ones who are violating this, and we are not. Member Harla.
I'm just going to say that I'll be standing with the Be Honest and Care for Other members for many reasons, but keeping it brief.
Member Slater-Punkle.
Thanks, Chair Murnicki. I just, 2 years ago when we voted on this, I remember Member Johnston brought the exact same thing, or maybe it was just the Be Honest part and Care for Others. And I know we had a discussion about that, and the reason we voted it down was because the Civility Project has put this together, exactly these 9 points, and I appreciate what Member Welty said about its honesty is subjective depending on who feels that they are being honest, even if maybe they aren't. So I remember us having this discussion, and we decided to stay with the 9 civility points for the simple reason that a lot of thought has been put into them, and the honesty part is included in all of this, and like Member Welty said, it is subjective, and you know, caring for others is in there too, showing respect. That is the whole thing with the golden rule. And so I just think that this is being redundant, and it's something that the board did vote on 2 years ago, and it was voted down because for those reasons that I stated.
Member Westholm.
Well, I my thinking is a little bit along what Member Slager-Punkle just stated. I'm not in favor of this because I'm not in favor of what Member Johnston is stating, but this is copyrighted document by this organization, and these are the 9 things that is part of their particular specific project, and I'm not sure I want to tamper with what they're doing. If there's a way to add this to our own thinking, yes, we're going to adopt the Civility Project, but in addition, you know, we have these other things that we want to consider, which would not be specifically altering this this particular, you know, again, copyrighted document. So that would be my objective. That's a pretty technical statement, but that's my thinking on it.
Member Johnston.
This is copyright. Why are we adopting something which somebody already has a copyright on? I'm not quite sure. I don't think we do it. I don't think there is a copyright on that. Too bad we couldn't get this person to speak to ask that. We obviously can't accept something which has been copyrighted by another organization. Again, every point is subjective. Member Slager-Punkle is my thing is subjective. Is there one of these 1 through 9 that are not extremely subjective? Every one of these are extremely subjective, and the objections to raising, talking about honesty and caring for others is a natural extension of the intent. Again, I know Anita and Rob, and they're very sincere on this. The Civility Project is very sincere on what they want to do, and I think that this goes right in there, that it defends exactly what we should be doing. And I'd like to remind the board that, as Member Murnicki said, we are a different board. There's 2 members on the board here that were there. This is a new board. And I'd like to remind them that we should not be doing exactly what the last board did. That's a very poor reason to continue something which is on the wrong track.
Member Harla. Member Welty.
I don't think of this as changing something that a lot of people have poured a lot of heart into. I think of this as our feeble attempt to improve upon the work of a lot of people who are trying to make the world a little bit better. And I think the issue of something having to do with the copyright, I think that's so technical that it doesn't bear consideration. I don't think that anybody in the Civility Project would mind our trying to enhance it, especially considering that we are obviously grappling with these issues on this board. We are, after all, adopting their 9 points. We're just simply trying to add something else to address some questions about whether the 9 are sufficient. And I don't think anyone in the Civility Project anywhere in the world would object to this 10th point that has been brought here. In fact, if there was an objection, it might be that it's a little bit too la-di-da. Well, okay for la-di-da. I think this is a nice point to add, and I don't think anybody in the Civility Project could object to it.
Member Laffer-Kemp.
Yeah, I guess Member Harla and I asked a couple months back for this to be brought forward again as a reaffirmation of the 9 tools of civility. And while I am not opposed to being honest and caring for others, what we asked to bring forward was the 9 tools of civility that the Duluth Superior Area Community Foundation has been asking boards all over to adopt. So I guess what I'd like to recommend is that if there is support for these 9 tools of civility, we adopt this. If we feel we want more discussion on additional tools, well, we do invite the Civility Project to another committee meeting to just give us more background on the project. But at this point, we're just reaffirming the 9 tools of civility.
Okay, and again, we're talking directly to the amendment right now. That's guys, it's 10:15, and if you know, it's late. Member Westholm.
My last comment is call it what it is. I agree with you that it, you know, this is a document that has the 9
points.
Points of civility, and we're adding our own addendum, which is fine. Then call it what it is. Yep. You know, it's an addendum that we want to make to this. You know, we're adopting this, but there's some other things we believe too. So that's the way I guess I'd get around it.
Mm-hmm. Member Harla.
I just wonder about the knowing that these have probably thousands of these have already been printed, I'm guessing, and knowing how what it costs to add these. I'm just wondering about, I know we're specifically talking about this amendment, but could we just say something below it? As the Duluth School Board, we also have honesty care. And then
we have an amendment on the floor.
Okay, sorry.
Okay, and I'm going to speak to it. I apologize for this. We appreciate the 9 points of civility. There's nothing I see that prevents us from going to 10. Member Johnston. Oh, Huey, I'm sorry. I think we have too many lights.
I guess I was thinking Member Westholm, excuse me. You mentioned an addendum. I mean, I would certainly, if we want to maybe take a quick recess, we could talk about what you had in mind. I don't really care if it's a 10-point, if it's an addendum, if you would support that. I would certainly consider amending my amendment, which, of course, we can do, to do something which, if it would be more palatable with Member Westholm or Member Harla. Okay.
Mr. Westholm, would you explain again what you had in mind?
Well, yeah, the Civility Project has adopted these 9 principles, which are good ones, but I don't know that our adding a tenth, we can't, I don't think we can add a tenth to this specific document because they've adopted these nine. But if we think what the tenth one or the additional one is important, and I agree with what Member Johnston says in a lot of ways, then let's not call it a tenth to this particular document because it's not our document. You know, this is not our project, but yet it's important to us as a board that we adopt this additional principle that we're adding to this. But we're not saying we're going to change this document. Obviously, we're not going to print new documents, but it is in addition to what the civility project has already put together. So that's, I guess, what I'm saying.
Member Welty.
I think we should recognize that we're not going to change the civility project worldwide. This will be our own eccentric little addition to what they've given to us. We've put our own 10th point on if we should choose to vote for it. I don't think that the civility project will unravel nationwide because one school district decided to add one more point to it, and I don't think that they will reprint all of these to reflect one little school district's amendment to their nine very worthy goals. So I think that we probably, if no one objects, can negotiate with them how we portray our adoption of their 9 points plus an addendum. But I think we can go ahead and vote on this now, and hopefully they won't implode if we do.
Superintendent Gronseth.
I just wanted to kind of harken back over the last few months. There's been several times where the board has inquired about doing a retreat and coming up with norms as a board for how we're going to operate. And I think that taking on the civility project or reaffirming the civility project could be a separate item from what you do in that retreat, and the norms that you come up with would probably be more specific than the civility project.
Member Johnson, I have a question. You have an amendment on the floor. It's been seconded. And you mentioned something about Mr. Weston's proposal. I want to do this correctly. Do you want us to vote on this amendment as it is? Okay. We're voting on the amendment to add a tenth, be honest, and care for other members. All in favor of adding this amendment signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
It passes 5-2. We now vote on the special resolution. All in favor of the special resolution signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It passes. If there's any other business, no other business, we are adjourned. Oh, I'm sorry. Member Johnston.
Yeah, and the question I had earlier, he said I could ask this here about the Piedmont, the teachers. That was the thing I was going to hold till now.
I'm sorry, I'm not hearing you. Oh. I apologize.
Oh, no, I had asked earlier when we were in the HR, I had a question about Piedmont, and he said to hold it till the end, so that's if we could have a...
Do we want to discuss this at a HR meeting, or do we? I'm not sure we can discuss this here.
Oh.
But I remember Mr. Gronseth, do you want to comment? Because I don't know. I guess we can, if you want to, I don't know.
You mentioned concern from the news report,
and no, from the people, from residents. I mean, yeah, it was in the paper too, but I don't think I read the article. But
I'm a little tired.
I did ask the table last.
The changes at Piedmont. There were several things that were going on. We did make a change in administration. This past fall, because we needed to see a change at Piedmont. Things weren't where we needed them to be. with that change in administration came different philosophies, different practices. And whenever there's change, there's bound to be a little pushback. That's not the only reason that there was the changes that we saw. As we talked about earlier, this is the first time in a very long time where we have a lot of choices for teachers to pick from in positions, because there were added teachers to almost every building, along with the retirements. And so this is first opportunity people have had for quite a while to move. So that's another reason. Also, a couple of the people took different positions other than teaching, so the new instructional coach positions, things like that.
But. Yeah, we can probably have a discussion later, but I just want to say that another school, the exact same situation, like Lincoln Park Middle School, there was almost no transfers. Again, I don't know, Piedmont isn't even in my district, but still, I hear a lot of from people in my district. So we can hold this to another meeting. I didn't want to hold it up, but I did want to bring it up. That's something I've been hearing from staff, and it does concern me. And you know, I'm hoping you're correct there. But when it does concern me, when it seems like too many teachers wanted to move, so we'll hold on to that. Hopefully, have another discussion.
No other discussion. No other issues. 4 hours. We are adjourned.
Harry, I have a golf.